시대 시대 2연속 우승
대한민국 ASL이 크림에 덮였어요. 정수가 지배하고 있습니다. 정말 내공 있는 플레이. 이게 진짜 유영진 선수의 매력이 아닐까. 유광석화 같은 한 줄기 네. 빛 같은 이재호인. 조재욱이 힘으로 상황을 반전시켜버리고
장윤찬 손을 발휘합니다.
포토스 그 자체 같은 이런 느낌이 좀 들 정도로
ASL 시즌 11 게임 준비 완료.
비가 내리는 3월의 마지막 일요일 새롭게 단장한 ASL 시즌 11으로 인사드립니다. 안녕하세요. 이연경입니다. 모든 만물이 새롭게 탄생하는 봄 ASL에도 새로운 바람이 불어왔는데요. 지난 3월 12일부터 14일에 펼쳐졌던 예선전 경기를 통해서 새롭게 3명의 선수들이 ASL 본선 무대에 합류했습니다. 지금까지 연속 두 번의 우승을 차지하면서 김명훈 선수가 군림하고 있는 저그의 강세가 이어질지 아니면 새로운 바람을 타고 테란과 프로토스의 반격이 시작될지 이번 시즌 역시 여러분들의 많은 성원과 관심을 부탁드리겠습니다. 자 그럼 24강 첫 번째 경기를 준비하고 있는 김정우 선수와 원지훈 선수 만나서 이야기 나눠보겠습니다. 안녕하세요.
네, 안녕하세요.
와 김정우 선수 이게 얼마만이에요. 너무 오랜만에 경기장에서 뵙게 된 것 같아요.
네네.
지난 시즌 7 이후 거의 3년 만에 오프라인 경기로도 찾아오게 됐는데요. 경기장에 오면서 좀 어떤 기분을 느끼셨나요?
정말 오랜만에 또 ASL 참가하게 돼서 너무 기쁘고요. 한편으로는 이제 오랜만에 해서 24강도 못 올라올 줄 알았는데 다행이라고 생각해 올라와가지고.
지금 사실 저와 인터뷰 나누기 전에 타이틀 영상을 쭉 보셨을 텐데 김명훈 선수가 요즘 이렇게 저그 원탑이라고 평가를 받고 있잖아요. 근데 사실 2020년 전까지는 유일한 저그 우승자가 또 김정우 선수였어요. 좀 김명훈 선수를 보면서 마음속에 뭔가 뜨겁게 불타오르는 뭔가 있지 않았을까 하는 생각도 들거든요.
예. 이제 군대에 있으면서 명훈이 형 우승하는 거 보고 저도 한 번 더 하고 싶다는 생각도 들었고요. 또 한편으로는 저 없을 때 우승한 거니까 이제 저 있을 때도 한번 할 수 있으면 해보세요.
김명훈 선수에게 먼저 선전폭으로 던진 김정우 선수인데요. 옆에 계신 원지훈 선수와도 좀 이야기를 나눠볼까요? 안녕하세요.
안녕하세요.
시즌 9 이후에 또 오랜만에 이렇게 24강 무대에 합류하게 되셨어요.
네.
저 소감이 어떠신지도 듣고 싶은데요.
그냥 올라와서 기쁘고 최대한 높게 올라가보고 싶어요.
지금 원지훈 선수에 대한 뜨거운 관심이 집중되고 있는 게 송병구 선수를 잡아내셨어요. 송병구 선수를 딱 잡아내고 본선 무대에 올라왔을 때 이번 시즌은 좀 다르겠다라는 느낌을 받으셨을까요?
그때 당시에는 그런 기분이었는데 최근에 제가 연습하면서 이제 잘하는 사람이랑 하다 보니까
네.
한계가 많이 느껴지더라고요. 그래서 최선을 다할 생각인데 생각보다 쉽지 않은 것 같아요.
그럼에도 불구하고 제가 SK ASL 질문을 쭉 받는 그 이벤트 게시글을 보다가 원준 선수가 직접 답변을 남긴 그 질문을 하나 봤습니다. 혹시 가장 견제되는 선수가 있냐 A조에서 라는 질문에 딱 네 글자로 없습니다라고 답변을 남겨주셨더라고요.
네.
이 자신감의 원천은 아무래도 완벽한 준비에서 나오지 않았을까 하는 생각도 드는데 준비 어떻게 해오셨을까요?
네, 열심히 했는데 솔직한 마음으로는 많이 힘들 것 같아요.
옆에 김정우 선수와의 첫 번째 경기가 가장 걱정이신 건가요?
그런 건 아니고 테란전이 좀 걱정이에요. 테란전.
김정우 선수가 웃습니다. 김정우 선수, 원준 선수가 굉장히 자신감 있는 모습으로 첫 번째 경기를 준비하고 있는 것 같은데요. 네. 어떠세요?
어차피 질 거라서 생각을 안 한 것 같아요.
테란 경기를 준비한 생각하고 있다고 하는데요.
그러니까는 너무 상대가 강하다 보니까 생각 안 하고 이제 테라는 어떻게든 만나서 잡고 올라가겠다 이 생각으로 온 것 같습니다.
아, 그럴 수 있죠. 워낙 또 프로토스전에 강한 김정우 선수고 독특한 스타일을 경기력을 또 보여주는 원지훈 선수이기 때문에 오늘 두 분의 경기를 굉장히 많은 분들이 기대하고 계세요. 서로를 생각했을 때 서로에 대한 이미지가 어떤지 김정우 선수, 원지훈 선수에 대해 어떻게 생각하세요?
예선하는 거 봤는데 네. 컨트롤 되게 잘하시더라고요. 예, 그냥 컨트롤 잘하시는 것 같아요.
원지훈 선수는 어떠세요?
그냥 스타판에서 한 획을 그은 적으라고 생각합니다.
굉장히 리스펙트하는 답변을 또 해주셨는데 자 그렇다면 이번에는 에스크 ASL을 통해서 팬 여러분들이 주신 질문을 좀 전달해 드려보도록 하겠습니다. 먼저 김정우 선수 최근 온라인에서 활약상을 보면 메들기와 메시아를 왔다 갔다 하는 것 같다 라고 좀 걱정 아닌 걱정을 해주시면서 메시아 모두 발동 가능할까요? 라고 물어봐 주셨거든요.
저도 언제 나올지 몰라가지고 저도 매번 저도 모르게 나와서 잘 모르겠습니다. 근데 열심히는 준비해봤으니까 잘 해보겠습니다.
원준 선수는 김정우 선수의 이 메시아 모드 보셨을 거 아니에요.
네.
좀 데뷔를 어떻게 해야겠다라고 생각하고 계실 것 같아요.
네네.
어떤 식으로 좀 데뷔를 해야 할까요?
그냥 안전하고 좀 단단하게 해야겠더라고요.
또 원지훈 선수에게 팬 여러분이 남겨주신 질문인데요. 아마추어 선수를 선전이 이렇게 계속해서 두각을 드러내고 있는데 기존에 프로 활동을 했던 선수들과 아마추어 선수들의 격차 원지훈 선수가 생각하시기에 그 격차가 어느 정도 좀 좁혀졌다고 느끼시나요?
일단은 그 대부분의 아마추어들은 아직 좀 프로게이머랑 하기에는 좀 힘들고 대다수의 아마추어들은 그 아마추어 중에 좀 잘하는 사람들 그 사람들은 이제 좀 프로게이머 중에 좀 낮은 티어에 있으신 분들하고는 좀 될 것 같아요, 게임이.
가장 원지훈 선수가 강하다고 생각하는 그럼 아마추어 선수는 어떤 선수인가요?
너무 당연하게도 짭제.
네. 자, 김정우 선수에게도 좀 같은 질문을 드려보고 싶은데 이 격차에 대해서 김정우 선수는 베테랑 선수로서 어떤 좀 생각을 가지고 계신지 듣고 싶어요.
최근에 들어서 진짜 많이 그 차이가 좁혀졌더라고요. 그래서 방금 원지훈 선수가 말한 짭제도 정말 많이 늘어가지고 거의 격차가 없을 정도로 많이 잘해졌어요.
자 일단 16강의 문턱을 넘기 위해서 오늘 경기가 두 분에게 모두 중요할 텐데요. 마지막으로 두 분의 각오를 좀 들어보도록 하겠습니다. 김정우 선수 먼저 부탁드릴게요.
오랜만에 이렇게 또 왔고 이제 기대해 주신 분들 많은데 대참사 안 일어나도록 잘 해보겠습니다.
멋진 경기 기대하겠습니다. 원지훈 선수 각오한 말씀 부탁드릴게요.
저는 어제부터 생각했는데 그냥 내일 스타 접는다는 생각으로 죽기 살기로 한번 해보려고요.
비장한 각오까지 너무 감사드리고요. 인터뷰 잘 들었습니다. 좋은 경기 기대하겠습니다.
감사합니다.
자 지금까지 24강 A조 첫 번째 경기를 준비하고 있는 두 선수 만나봤고요. 자 계속해서 24강 A조의 두 번째 경기를 펼칠 두 선수도 만나봐야겠죠. 조일장 선수와 황병영 선수 만나보도록 하겠습니다. 두 분 안녕하세요.
안녕하세요.
네, 두 선수 모두 이번 시즌 정말 정말 어렵게 본선에 이렇게 합류하게 되셨습니다. 조일장 선수는 1일차, 2일차 모두 결승에서 또 패배를 좀 경험하셨다가 3일차에 또 이렇게 본선 무대에 합류하게 되셨는데요. 힘들게 뚫고 올라온 만큼 이번 시즌 좀 뭔가 보여주겠다라는 각오가 남다르실 것 같아요.
일단은 예선 때 진짜 힘들게 뚫어가지고 3일차에도 걱정을 많이 했는데 그래도 올라올 수 있게 돼서 좋았고 근데 오히려 힘들게 올라오다 보니까 뭔가 부담감이 좀 내려가면서 좀 편하게 임할 수 있을 것 같아요.
이미 손은 다 풀었다라는 느낌을 좀 받으실 것 같아요.
네, 맞습니다.
황병영 선수 역시 이번 시즌 3일차 경기만에 정말 좀 어렵게 올라오셨는데 그럼에도 불구하고 3시즌 연속 본선 무대에 함께하고 계시잖아요. 이번 시즌에 대한 느낌은 좀 어떠세요?
그동안 한 것 중에 그래도 제일 실력적으로 좀 자신이 있어가지고 제일 할만하다고 생각해요. 그 전에는 좀 좀 힘들 거라고 생각했는데 오늘은 또 뭐 자신 있게 할 수 있을 것 같아요.
오늘 무대는 좀 자신이 있다라고 답변을 해주셨는데 좀 의외라는 생각이 드는 게 저 생각이 굉장히 많아질 거라고 생각을 했거든요. 황경영 선수가 왜냐하면 본인을 또 1일차, 2일차에서 떨어뜨렸던 장본인들이 또 김정우 선수와 원주은 선수이기 때문에 같은 조에서 경기를 할 생각을 했을 때 머릿속이 좀 복잡하지 않을까라는 생각을 했거든요.
그거는 좀 제가 잘 못해가지고 진 것 같고 오늘은 제가 준비를 또 잘 해왔기 때문에 전 대회에서 원래 더 잘하는 스타일이라서
그렇죠.
잘 할 수 있을 것 같아요.
할 수 있다. 네. 16강에 갈 수 있다.
예.
조일장 선수도 여러 가지로 좀 고민이 많을 만한 오늘 경기일 것 같은데 또 워낙 좀 테란전 기록에서 온라인에서 좀 고전을 많이 하는 모습들이 있어서 팬 여러분들도 좀 떨어지는 거 아니야? 24강에서 설마 조일장 선수가 이런 생각을 하고 계시는 분들도 있는데 조일장 선수 본인도 좀 걱정되는 부분이 있으실까요?
저는 사실 테란전을 잘 못한다고 생각 안 하는데 이게 좀 예전부터 제가 성적이 많이 안 좋았다 보니까 좀 그런 식으로 인식이 많이 자리 잡은 것 같아서 근데 요즘에는 또 테란전 자신 있어가지고 오늘 별로 걱정 안 하고 왔어요.
걱정되는 부분은 없다.
네.
알겠습니다. 자, 양 선수에게도 팬 여러분들이 남겨주신 질문을 좀 전달해 드리겠습니다. 먼저 조일장 선수 예선에서 3일 모두 결승에 올라갔기 때문에 예선 다승왕 이라는 타이틀이 좀 따라붙게 됐는데요. 본선에서 다승왕은 우승이잖아요.
네.
근데 여지까지 이제 우승을 한 선수들이 하위 그라운드에서 쉽게 올라온 선수들은 없었던 것 같아요. 그만큼 좀 보생을 많이 하면 할수록 더 높은 곳에 올라갈 수 있겠다라는 생각도 드는데요. 이번 시즌 재패에 대한 좀 가능성은 어떻게 점쳐보고 계시나요?
일단 저도 이렇게 3일차까지 예선을 해본 적이 잘 생각이 안 나는데 뭔가 해보니까 알겠더라고요. 이제 더 이상 내려갈 데도 없겠구나. 그래가지고 이제 좀 마음 편하게 이번 시즌 하다 보면은 좀 좋은 성적 거둘 수 있지 않을까 생각하고 있습니다.
조일장 선수 역시 자신감이 있지만 황병영 선수도 계속해서 자신감 있는 답변을 내주고 계셔서 기대가 굉장히 됩니다. 또 저그전 충분히 이변을 일으킬 수 있다라고 또 본인이 선전포고를 하셨다고 들었는데 이번 시즌 어디까지 올라갈 수 있을 거라고 좀 생각하시나요?
그 생각을 안 해봐가지고 잘 모르겠는데 저는 원래 앞만 보고 이제 하는 스타일이라서 뭐 딱히 목표는 없고요. 그냥 오늘 무조건 이기자라는 생각으로 잘 해보도록 하겠습니다.
황병영 선수에게 팬 여러분이 남겨주신 질문입니다. 황병영 선수가 경기장에 등장하면 사실 이 질문을 늘 올려주시는 것 같아요. 팬 여러분들께서 ASL 24강 진출자 중 외모 탑3에 드는 선수가 누가 있을까요? 라는 질문이 사실 굉장히 많아요. 그래서 황병영 선수가 어떤 답변을 하실지 곤란하시진 않을지 저도 질문을 드리면서 좀 걱정을 많이 했는데 오히려 좀 자신 있게 답변을 하신다고 제가 들었거든요. 어떤 것 같으세요?
저번에도 얘기했듯이 일단 저는 포함이 돼 있는 것 같고요.
잠시만요. 조일장 선수 지금 일단 본인은 제외하고 두 자리 남았거든요. 본인이 있을까요?
저도 양심이 있기 때문에 탑3에는 힘들 것 같습니다.
그럼 황병현 선수 답변을 좀 해주시죠.
나머지 두 명이요?
네.
일단 태경이 형 있는 것 같고요. 제가 생각하는 어떤 그거니까 어차피.
네, 그렇죠. 개인적인 취향이니까요.
그리고 창경? 4강에서도.
네, 24강 진출자 선수들 중에서요.
그러면은
이렇게 고민이 길어질 질문일 줄 사실 잘 몰랐습니다. 나머지 답변은 제가 또 나중에 개인 방송을 통해서 한번 들어보도록 하겠습니다. 일단 가장 자신 있게 본인은 꼽으셨으니까요. 네, 오늘 잘생긴 경기력 역시 기대하도록 하겠습니다. 마지막으로 두 선수에게 각오 한 말씀씩 좀 들어볼까요? 조일장 선수.
네, 일단 오늘 좀 편하게 생각하고 왔는데 또 경기 준비는 또 잘해왔으니까 좋은 경기력으로 좋은 모습 보여드리도록 하겠습니다.
네, 황병현 선수 한 말씀 부탁드릴게요.
저도 뭐 얼굴만큼 깔끔한 경기력 보여드리도록 하겠습니다.
기대하도록 하겠습니다. 두 분 인터뷰 감사드리고요. 멋진 경기 기대할게요. 감사합니다.
감사합니다.
네, 하식스와 LG 울트라기어가 함께하는 ASL 시즌 11 24강 개막전 경기. 과연 어떤 선수가 가장 먼저 16강 진출의 기쁨을 누릴 수 있을지 개막전 첫 번째 경기 지금 바로 시작하겠습니다.
The arc of the universe does indeed bend towards justice. ASL season 11 is here, and it is casted by Tasis and Artosis. Guys, we love you. Thank you for saving us.
Yeah, I can't believe this one. ASL English broadcasting got canceled. I thought we were done for.
We were very sad.
The greatest tournament is yeah. over as far as English goes.
We walked out of the offices and said, I guess it's over. It was a big bummer for us.
It was terrible. But
it was so sad. But you guys saved us. Thank you so much for supporting us. We appreciate it. And here we are now on the first day of season 11.
Yeah. Yeah. It's so exciting. Like because it felt very dark. Right. It felt so yeah. dark when the English broadcast got canceled after 10 seasons. But the outpouring of support from you guys on the Patreon has been unreal. And I feel like now, like I've always felt like Brood War will never die. But now, like, especially it won't die.
Yeah.
You know, it's like,
yeah, no kidding. And I'm,
we can't be stopped.
And I'm so,
English Brood War can't be stopped.
Well, also, it's great because we get to preserve the history mm-hmm. of StarCraft. This is the oldest esport. This really is the esport that started it all. And there's no reason to ever stop playing it. And I'm glad we can carry the history on in the English world. And I don't want this to just be isolated to the Korean speakers out there. So this is absolutely. Great. So again, thank you guys so much.
Yeah. Yeah. Thanks for that, guys. And you can check it out, patreon.com/ASL English. Now, that being said, yeah, here we are. It's season 11.
Right.
We have the best lineup that we have probably ever had, and we will talk about that just momentarily. But taking a look, of course, as I mentioned, you can check out the Patreon if you would like to help support. We have a lot of great stuff planned. The sport has been so much that we're really looking to move beyond even just ASL.
That's right. We've got a lot of big plans here in the future. Of course, in our tournament, $30,000 roughly for the champion here. So mm-hmm. a lot on the line here. The last ASL was an intense one. We've had quite a bit of time off here, mm-hmm. At least as far as ASLs go. So we're back here now. We've got some new maps too.
Yeah, yeah. So we have some older maps like Fighting Spirit and Polaris Rhapsody. Then we have a couple ladder maps in Eclipse and Polypoid. And then we have new maps. We have Ascension, Ultimate Stream, and Hidden Track. And we'll talk more about those maps a little bit later on. Something to mention is this is round of 24 is best of one. All the matches are best of one. We're starting on Eclipse, then we're going to Ascension, then there will be a veto phase for the elimination matches where you get to veto a map so you're not playing on something that you feel really uncomfortable on. As we go up into the round of 16, it's going to be best of one for matches where you don't get eliminated, and then best of three if you are in an elimination match. That would be the final matches of the night. When we get beyond there, we'll be in the round of eight, which will be best of fives. And then, of course, we move upwards, round of four finals. Those become bigger and bigger sets. And it just, I mean, you guys know.
You guys know how this works. So, yeah, the round of 24, of course, it can be very unforgiving. You know, there's a lot of different ways a StarCraft game can go. So mm-hmm. a lot on the line here. It's going to be interesting to see how things unfold. Our player lineup, this is very much not like a GSL right now. We have 11 Terrans
yeah.
here.
Yeah.
7 Protosses and 6 Zergs.
Yeah, and don't forget, we do have the seeds from last season that aren't shown here. 0, Soma, Larva. So that's actually 9 Zergs, and then one more Terran in Rush. He did win Flash's spot. For people wondering, Flash has his shoulder injury acting up once again, so he is sitting out this season, unfortunately. But Rush is considered the third best Terran. He won his spot, so that's amazing to see. Of course, we have a lot of new players here. Big shout out to my boy Scan.
Yeah,
the whole scene
Scan's
loves
here.
Him. Yeah, I love him being in ASL. I cannot wait to see how he does. And a lot of up and coming Terrans added in there, which is why I was saying this is the best season yet, because we have the most Terrans.
This is going to be a good season for Artosis. He's going to be getting a lot of builds.
Yeah.
This is the other funny thing about this line of work for us is, you know, we love StarCraft and we love RTS, but there's also the selfish purposes of like, Okay, what are they going to do so that we can steal that and use that on the ladder?
I tell you, that one KSL season that we had where it was all Protosses, I asked my mom if I could move back into back into her basement in New Hampshire.
It was a great season for me. I'm like, I am learning everything that I need right now. This is a dream come true.
Totally.
So we've got a bit of a Terran-heavy ASL, but I do think a lot of these Terrans are on the weaker side compared to some of these other players. So I think it should start to even out as we get further and further along. To start this off here in Group A, we've got quite an exciting lineup of players. Effort, Hero, Barrix, and Sins.
Yeah, this is really exciting because Effort, this guy was the champion of the tournament that led into ASL, like the Vant Star League or whatever it was called.
Right.
That's when we started being able to cast Brood War again.
So we started pleading to let them let us cast. Yeah.
And they did. And of course, he beat Flash in a more recent ASL in the finals. Hero has also met Flash in the finals, did fall there, though. But he's back in very good shape. Effort just fresh out of the military. Then, of course, Barrix is an up-and-coming Terran. I personally am very excited about him. I love his style. He's a little bit aggressive and has very fresh builds. And then we have Sins, who is Storm Egg, and we'll talk more about him as we get there.
Young Storm Egg is here. now, Effort, you mentioned he just finished his military service. I'm really excited to see how he's going to perform, not just like in this ASL, but in years to come now, because basically, when you're a Korean pro, the military service that you're required to do for a little bit under 2 years, you can't compete. It oftentimes ruins careers. But now that we know that StarCraft's going to go on probably forever, he's past that point in his life. Now he can do a deep dive back into the game. And of course, Effort was one of the most feared Zergs of all time. If you guys haven't been able to check out his stream on Africa TV, mechanically, he is so gifted, it's insane.
Oh, yeah.
One of the most impressive players to watch.
Yeah, I almost feel bad because he's not, like, listed in those four players, right? Where it's like, yeah, it's everyone talks about the top four, of the biggest era of Brood War, which was Flash, Jadong, Stork, and Bisou.
Right.
But right, like, fifth place was actually Effort. Like, right? It was like Effort, maybe Fantasy, and Zhongbi were the next three. And it's like, guys, they're basically that level. And in fact, Effort is the only person who has a winning record against Flash in best of fives, just to show his level.
Yeah. Going up here against Sins, I mean, I feel like, and maybe this is a little bit of my bias from following StarCraft for so long, but I feel like Effort should just be the stronger player.
Yeah, but Sins is a newer player. This is Storm Egg, if you guys remember from a couple seasons ago when he stormed the eggs and we flipped out about it.
What was that map?
The Inner Coven.
Inner Coven, that's right.
Yeah.
Good riddance. I'm so glad we don't have that map anymore.
But look, Sins is super strong, but yeah, Effort is like, honestly, like Zero won the last couple ASLs. But now that Effort's back, if I was Zero, I'd be shaking in my boots, right? Because this is the guy that'll get you and like not let you win a third.
Well, also, with Zero or Queen, he's so good at Zerg versus Zerg, but Effort is a real killer in this matchup. So, Effort being here in this tournament, it's going to change the landscape of the entire ASL for sure. And I believe we're moments away from hopping into our first game again. This is a best of one, Sins versus Effort in Group A of the ASL. Let's go. Stop laughing, Artos. This is serious.
Taste is making me laugh off camera, guys.
Sorry. Doing silly stuff. Okay, we're back. And so this is on the map Eclipse. It's a one-on-one map. We have the Zerg in the bottom left, the Protoss in the upper right. And let's go big picture here. PVZ on this map.
Yeah.
There's funny dilemmas for both sides in this matchup on this map. And basically, it comes down to controlling the upper left and the bottom right.
Mm.
In PvZ, both the Protoss and the Zerg can take what I call them nook expansions, these little tiny areas. You'll see them on Fighting Spirit, top, bottom, left, right, where it's one ramp leading up into a pretty. It can be a very congested area if there are cannons, if there's sunken colonies or spores.
Sure.
And so it's tricky.
Those expansions are always, I think, across all matchups, the hardest ones to break.
Right. But especially in PvZ, like a Zerg on a low ground trying to get up into that, let's say it's one of these bottom right bases.
Mm-hmm.
If either side can sneak in and take those, it gets extremely difficult to recover.
Mm-hmm.
But so you want to have those watched, whether you're the Zerg or the Protoss, as you're both expanding towards the upper left.
Mm-hmm.
if we do go, in fact, into a late game.
Well, I do hope that we do end up going there. Is this map, like, how would you rate this map for a Protoss versus Zerg? Like, is it a map that Protoss is very happy to play on? It feels like
I think it's
pretty
map.
Decent for PVC.
I think it's fine.
Yeah.
I think it's completely fine. Like I said, I mean, it can be a little bit difficult to stop them from getting the bottom right base while you're pushing mm-hmm. up to the upper mm-hmm. left. But if you do get the upper left base, that's double gas.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you're really comfortable. At that point in time, this is a map where you can run out of expansions pretty quickly.
Oh, yeah,
too.
Yeah.
Unlike, you know, some maps where it can go on and on and on and on.
It is, yeah, I think it's one of the only popular maps right now where you can actually mine it out.
Right.
Like a lot of these maps, like you play Polypoid, yeah, that's not getting mined out.
No. The odds the of game, it, yeah.
Yeah, there's too many resources. One of you is going to kill the other one before that's gone.
Precisely.
Whereas this one, it's like, yeah, it can get cut in half. And definitely can get mined out now.
And I actually think this is one of the best new maps that we've had.
Oh, yeah.
I think it's fun in all the matchups. I think TVP can be a little bit hard for the Terran to get the third up and keep it. But overall, I think in most of the matchups, it's pretty interesting.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, I'm the first person to complain about TVP, but I think it's a great map for TVP. I think it's one of those maps where this is clearly one of the best maps ever made. Like. We have several of those maps nowadays. I think like Polypoid, Neosilphid, Eclipse. These are maps where it's like, well, damn, like every matchup is good.
Yeah.
We finally have some of these maps where it's like I can play endless games here and be happy.
And I think even though we haven't had the most success with these super out there maps,
mm-hmm.
Like Inner Coven was one we were mentioning earlier, I'm glad that we're still experimenting with that as well. Here in the scene.
Mm-hmm.
So this time around, it's going to be the Ling's coming up. This is a very early pool, and he's going to have some pressure coming in here. Now, I think that, frankly, Protoss should be fine. He's got one Zealot coming through here. As long as the Ling's don't get up into the main, and you want to use the probes to block that, you should be in good shape.
Really nice micro so far. Like, we saw him blocking while we were talking there, you know, that third base a little bit with the probe, and now we have this Zealot micro going, oh, he actually gets the drone! But yeah, it also feels like he's doing some great blocking here with just three probes and a couple Zealots.
Yeah, it can be risky to send that Zealot out, but if he can actually get a kill here, that would be huge. Looks like he's going to dive on this, and he...
Oh my god, he got two drones with that Zealot!
That's really big. Keep in mind, you know, there's not a lot of drones. With the build that the Zerg did, this is actually pretty bad for effort. It's kind of unheard of to get two drone kills. Sometimes you'll get one, but that's a lot.
That is a lot. For the first Zealot?
Yeah. So now what does he want to do? I mean, he's going to have to drone up.
He wants to go back to the military.
He's going to... He's going to get his forge up here. I don't think that there's any way for the Zerg to do any real damage to the Protoss. As long as the entrances are all plugged up with Zealots,
mm-hmm.
he's going to be fine. I guess the question now is, does Zerg want to go into a lair? Is there a chance he wants to throw down a Hydralisk den?
Well, he hasn't caught the probe yet, so I feel like he doesn't have like too many options to be cheesy here, right?
Yeah, that's a good point. The probe is still on the move. I don't see Ling's speed done yet. Basically, you can keep a probe alive pretty much forever if you're babysitting it enough. And he is going to go for three hatch Hydra.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
All right. Now, do you think it's going to be like a three hatch Hydra all in? Or is he going to do one of these, I make some and make you think it's an all in, but really I'm just killing your forge and your gate?
Well, it's a good question. I mean, it's, you know, it's very common now for the Protosses to put the cannon far back.
Mm.
You know, in the older days, you'd have the cannon right up in the front.
Why? Is that to make sure it does not die if a quick Hydra bust comes?
Yeah. Because okay. Otherwise they'll just run up and kill it. And so the response to that is to have a cannon that's like back enough that the Hydras can't... The gateway blocks it in such a way that the Hydras can't reach that back cannon mm-hmm. without, you know, it being a real headache. And so...
Is that a more recent development, by the way? I'm just curious.
I didn't notice it until, you know, we started casting again. You know, when we got our first casting game for StarCraft 1 again.
Sure,
I mean,
you and I think
both weren't particularly following StarCraft 1 when StarCraft 2 came out because we had so much StarCraft 2 casting, but I saw it mostly after that.
Okay.
This may be an all-in, it may not. It also may be a response to the fact that he lost two drones. He might say, okay, I'm not comfortable playing a game this in the long run.
Dude, yeah, that's kind of a funny thing that you see from Zerg players sometimes, which I don't even really quite understand. Like, if I kill one of the first Overlords... 90% of the time a speedling all-in comes.
Yeah.
It's like, wait a minute. Are you that tilted by that, really?
I think it's basically just an odds game. It's like, well, I'm going to have a much better shot of trying to do this. Now, in this case, obviously, the Zealot Scout is incredible.
Yeah.
And I felt like that went right under the Overlord, by the way. So that was a little bit odd. He has another zealot. This is a great hidden zealot to have here, because these zealots, when the Hydra attack comes, they're not that useful. So it's better to send that in there and try to kill one or two more drones. And this looks like he's already decided. Okay, I'm learning right now. This is so cool, because he's already decided he's going to give up on the forge.
Yeah, I know. I love that. To see him just make the forge his main. He's like, well, 100% I'm losing these buildings. And that goes so... I'm getting chills right now, Tasis. Like, look at this row of cannons he's made, how far back it is. It's like, these are just buying him time, these buildings up here. In fact, he's attacking the egg. Storm Egg is now Cannon Egg.
This is wild. He's, looks like we're actually going to have him try to maybe dive in. The positioning of the cannons, though, was quite good. Here comes that Zealot. This is actually more important than the rush itself on the other side of the map, because... This can completely hiccup everything. Keep in mind, a layer's coming here, so the Zerg is not all in. He can develop behind this. But
Sins is looking like a badass, man.
Yeah, and three Dragoons here. Did he actually get Dragoon range? I didn't catch this.
Yeah, I'm not entirely sure, but he's keeping so big of tabs. Wow, I can't speak at all. I'm sorry, guys. You shouldn't be doing any of this all. But he's getting so much scouting intel with these Zealots that... He can just go, like, ground pounding. He does not need a Corsair or anything.
No. He's fine. I mean, this is basically pretty much gone perfectly for the Protoss. Spire's thrown out immediately after that.
As I say that.
What, is that double Robo?
Double Robo?
Whoa.
What is this, Tasteless?
It's a Reaver build. People in my Twitch chat are going to be like, Tasteless, I told you, could you stop these Hydra Busters? I'm always going to ask this in my Twitch chat. They're like... Can you just stop that with Reavers? I'm like, well, you could, but then you're not going to be in a great spot later on. But this is very interesting. This is not normal. It could be telegraphed by the four Dragoons. When you see Dragoons like that, you begin to scratch your head. Dragoons this early can only mean Robo build, or it can be the five-gate goon all-in.
Yeah, you were telling me about this five-gate goon all-in. Maybe that's what he thinks it is?
Yeah, well, he didn't see the gateways, though.
He
didn't see the robo, but he didn't see the gateways either. So he knows it's not the five gate.
He hasn't seen anything.
Yeah.
He saw a Stargate with one Corsair and four Dragoons.
So he's got two Robos. And the reason why this is important is the Reaver push can come out not only quickly, but it can come again and again and again.
Mm-hmm.
This is countered, though, by Mass Muta.
Oh, okay.
You know, if you're going against...
He does have the Stargate, though.
He does.
So he could go Corsair.
He could. That's correct. But if there's enough...
Just making sure.
but there's enough right now that this is a real threat. You know, you can pop out Mutalis much more quickly than Corsairs, which are incremented out one by one. But yeah, this appears to me that he's going to keep making Dragoons and basically have a push that, if I'm correct, will probably be angled towards this area here, the natural. We mentioned earlier, it's a headache to try to push up into these areas.
Yeah. Well, pushing up a ramp with a Reaver against Static D
as well is just
that would just not work, right?
Yeah.
It's not that the Reaver will miss shots, it's that it won't make them.
Yeah, it will just sit there until the Sunken Colony kills it.
I've seen it.
It's rough. So the Mutas are out.
Yeah, and he's catching this Corsair. Nice moving shot, chasing it down. I mean, does this really hiccup the plan when you see this many Mutas?
I mean, it certainly can. I mean, you know, the danger is that you can lose the shuttle, right? To Scourge, or the Mutas can snipe it. Dragoons can fight Mutas, but you can see they don't. It takes them a while to kill him.
Mm-hmm.
The Mutas can basically ignore this.
And he killed a few probes, but he still hasn't seen the two Robos.
Yeah, this is one of the odder PVZs, because this build is so unusual, and Zerg is scouted about 70% of everything that Protoss has.
But except the most important thing.
Yeah, except the key is part of the strategy. Mm-hmm. Now, I also wonder if the double Robo was because he thought this was going to be a Hydra all-in.
Well,
do you see what I'm saying? Like,
according to your Twitch chat, that would be an amazing counter, from what I understand.
And finally, Tasteless gets
those chat scientists, they've done the math.
These chat GMs.
Well, Storm Egg is doing it.
Yeah, he's serious about this. One thing about Corsair, Dragoon, and Reaver is that this doesn't develop into the healthiest late game.
No, yeah, it doesn't.
This
look
is
like it. Where's your size?
This is tech fast food here. Okay, this is not
food.
You can
love it.
You can.
He still hasn't seen the Reavers.
Yeah, this is so funny.
He's gonna be so caught off guard. Look at this. It looks like this army kills him, right?
I am so curious about what's going to happen here, because Zerg's going to go for a Lurker Contain, which is going to backfire. Reavers can just push out of this, no problem.
Oh, here we go.
Here we go.
Now he's like, wait, why do you have a Reaver there? Reaver Corsair? But we haven't seen a shuttle. Oh my god, he got Reaver damage. Is that
worth it?
Oh my
god, I didn't even notice that.
This is crazy. Oh my god. Okay, so some lurkers burrow. He pulls back four Reavers. You can't attack into this effort. What are you doing?
Oh my god, one of the Scarabs actually dudded on a Zealot.
Oh!
I'm sorry, is there an Observer here? I don't think
that there is, but he does have two Robos, so I'm not too worried about it.
Yeah, no doubt. I mean, he can easily get Observers at Observer speed, but what's funny is there's no shuttle with this either. Guys, keep in mind...
You'd need a third Robo for the shuttle, Tasteless.
That's right. And a fourth one for the Observers.
Don't get ahead of yourself, Tasteless. It's too much.
If you're not making shuttles, how are you going to have Reavers come out two at a time, you idiot?
Yeah. God.
You know, it's funny, guys, because remember, this is a best of one, and anybody who's ever followed StarCraft knows this isn't what a normal early game looks like. So he is very confident that this is how he's going to take a win. So the
Dude, it looks pretty good. What beats this right now without Hive?
Does he just slow crawl across the map? Is that the game plan?
Well, it's not going to be a fast crawl with Reavers on the ground.
Can you imagine if Reavers were fast, how scary that would be?
Oh, that would be the dumbest thing
Reavers
ever.
Reavers moving at like with Ling speed, you know, movement. That would
oh,
be,
my God. Yeah. Giving me nightmares.
Yeah. Wake up in a cold sweat. So I guess this is just... We call this type of idea crawling Reaver. And,
do we?
Yeah. There's a couple weird PvP builds that have come in and out of style where it's like, if you're close enough, you can just walk the Reaver with your Dragoons over there.
Hmm.
You know? And yeah, this is... Either this is very... bad or very good. I can't even tell right now.
I haven't casted anything
like this.
It's so many Reavers here. Okay, the Hydra's coming up and trying to target this down. The Mutas try to help as well. The Corsairs knock them out of the air immediately. There are a lot of dead Hydras here now.
This is fascinating. And now he's gotten to the most important landmass on the map for the push, which is the high ground here. Because everything can be reinforced from this point on. But so many plot twists here. Upgrading the Reaver speed. See, in my head, I was imagining shuttle speed was being upgraded here.
Yeah.
Not the case at all.
Just the damage, man. 125.
Yeah.
That's some serious damage on that splash.
And, I mean, obviously, Reaver's one-shot Scarabs. How many hit points does a Lurker have?
125? So but they have an armor.
Okay, so it doesn't one-shot it, right?
Yeah, no, it doesn't one-shot it. It gets it down to, like, one health.
Oh, wow, but the counterattack, there's a novel idea here as well.
Well, he has a lot, actually, and that Reaver does reasonably well. Kills five Hydras on its way out.
Oh, sure, yeah.
Okay, now, he's actually come back to meet the Hydras with his Dragoons. That doesn't feel quite right, though. I don't know about this move.
Well, he's able to cut off the reinforcements. This is so funny. This is slow. These Zealots do not have the speed upgrade, correct?
No. He can't have every... Does he also have a carrier? No. Yeah, no. No, he doesn't have that either. You don't even have to show me his main. I know it.
Unreal. So he's going to push in here. Now, Dragoons are okay against Hydras if you have enough of them. But you basically need the Zealots to be soaking up damage. The thing about Dragoons, though, is if you micro them, you can oftentimes get away without really losing anything. So this should be the boiling point here. This is going to be where we're going to see how this rush actually works. Now, in general, the theory is you can have there is such a thing as too many Reavers.
We're going to test that for sure.
You beat me to it because normally, you know, they tend to shoot if you have enough of them. They tend to shoot the same target and it gets redundant with Scarabs.
Yeah, that makes sense.
But the fact of the matter is, you could chew your way through static defense like nobody's business.
Well, he's doing that against these burrowed lurkers. Now, here comes the army. A bunch of Scarabs coming out on both sides. The flank seems pretty decent.
Yeah, shots coming out and connecting. I feel like there might, even though I think Protoss can barely win this fight, I think there's just too much.
You know what? He is. Yeah, we're watching three Scarabs, then two Scarabs hit exactly the same Hydra multiple times here. If those had spread a little bit more, he would have slaughtered that, I think.
Yeah, this
but
is
instead,
why
he gets pushed back.
Yeah, exactly. This is why you don't normally see more than two or three Reavers in a given spot, because it's just not going to do that much more. But, you know, Effort has played this pretty intelligently. I guarantee you this was not the game he imagined he'd be playing right now.
No, certainly not.
But I think that essentially this whole thing has backfired now. And I think Zerg can basically just win the game from here.
Well, he's on four bases, and it looks like just the same push, but smaller is coming back out. Doesn't feel like this transitioned all that well, unfortunately.
Yeah.
But Tasteless, could this be the future of PvZ? Like when you get like targeting all sorts of different things with those Reavers, you know?
It makes me wonder. It really does. I do feel like there's no reason to not at least have one shuttle here. You know, even just to ferry more Reavers over to the area. But it definitely seems like it's a build that has to work at a specific time. And here we're seeing, again, redundancy with the Scarabs.
Yeah. Yeah, they really are targeting a lot of the same things.
But keep in mind, there are some maps where you do have, you know, spawns that are a little bit closer, and maybe that's where this could have some viability. So Effort shuts that down, I think, really exhibiting why he's such an expert. You know, he realized, okay, this push is coming. The best move is to almost treat it like it's a... it's going to sound weird. The Zerg has to play like it's a PVT. Like, run behind the reinforcements and catch it. And if the army's out there for long enough, then you're eventually going to have enough to kill it. And clearly, a build like that, once you stop it, the game pretty much grinds
to a halt.
Kill
the Reavers, it's hard to really remake, I guess.
Yeah.
That was a very cool strategy, though. I do wonder if there's some real potential there, if you're targeting a little bit better. Maybe you have them stifled a little bit differently or something like that. Like, yeah, hard to say, but if those, like, for instance, in some of those battles, I saw, like, six Scarabs hit things that weren't useful.
Yeah, this is the problem. It can hit too many locations. Guys, we're going to have a short break, I think, and then we're going to go into our next game, guys. We'll be right back.
Let's go. GeForce GTX 1650 그래픽 최신 인텔 10세대 프로세서 탑재 고성능 노트북의 새로운 기준 LG 울트라 기어
야야 조금만 버텨 조금만 바로 내일이 치팅데이다 내일이다 내일 모레도 아니고 내일이다
이상한데? 그렇게 작아.
너무 안 보이는데?
보이지가 않잖아.
쓸 수 아니, 있는데?
아니, 저 키워보라고.
성능. 17대화면으로 언제 어디서나 더 크게 즐기다. WQXGA 초고화질의 17대화면 16:10 최적의 화면비 고성능 노트북의 새로운 기준 LG 울트라 기어
What's up everybody? We're back and we're going to be going into game 2 momentarily here, but first we want to plug our Patreon, guys. Thank you so much for supporting us. We hope you guys continue to support us through the year. We're going to have new goals and try to keep building this thing up.
Yeah, look, we want to do more than just ASL. I mean, we're just so happy and grateful and thankful to be able to continue doing ASL. But yeah, we want to expand out from there, and we have a lot of really good ideas for it. We're going to be putting stuff like some behind-the-scenes photos, for instance, that we took today, and all sorts of fun stuff. So yeah, check it out, guys. That's patreon.com/ASL English.
We love you guys. Thank you so much for the support. And we're going to be hopping into our next match here momentarily. But just to go back to that first game, Artosis, I got to say, man, I did not expect to have the Reaver crawl like that. I don't know if he should have actually pulled the trigger and gone in and attacked then or not. But it's one of these things that really starts to make my juices turn around in my head. About, you know, is there a completely alternative way to effectively play a PvZ?
Yeah, no. Even on that commercial break, we were actually talking about it. Like, what if you spread the attacks? That could be very cool. But I hope to see more of it. We'll see. But up next, Tasteless, we have a Zerg versus Terran. We have Hero, one of the greatest, most respected Zergs out there. He's been out of the military for a while now. He's in pretty darn good shape. Of course, he's gone to the ASL finals before, where he did lose to Flash. He's in that club, as so many are. And yeah, I would put him as one of the favorites of the group as well. I mean, obviously we have, in a group like this, it's like, well, you have Effort and Hero. What do you want, right? Like, they have to be the favorites. but his opponent, Barracks, I pride myself on keeping up on a lot of the up-and-coming Terrans, and I've been watching him for a long time. He's one of these guys that is a bit younger and has, like, all the fresh builds. You can actually really tell the difference when you look at, like, the players that are up-and-coming Terrans and then the players that are older Terrans, because older Terrans are more stuck in their ways and use older builds a lot of the time, whereas every time I watch Barracks, he's got the sharpest thing that there is for Terran at the moment.
It reminds me a little bit of Mini, where Mini's like really kind of doing his own thing.
Oh, okay.
As a Protoss player, I'm like, huh, you're really experimenting with a lot of ideas people thought weren't that good, and he's making it work.
Mm-hmm.
And I kind of would put Barracks in a similar spot to that.
Sure, and you know, he is. I generally tend to think of him as like, very much at the front of the pack. He's one of those Terrans with all the freshest builds and drives the coolest cars and stuff like that. But he's
hangs out with the hottest dudes.
He totally does. You know that up at the top of the ladder.
That's right.
You know that handsomeness has only to do with MMR. Mm-hmm. Yeah, here we go, guys. It's going to be Eclipse once again. A Zerg versus Terran, Hero versus Barracks. I would favor Hero slightly, but...
I think you have to, right?
Yeah, but, I mean, Barracks, he knows how to play, man. And the thing is, I like all three of his matchups. He's not one of those Terrans where I'm like, oh, he's got a weak matchup, which is... Yeah. I would feel like maybe a third of really high-level Terrans, they have one matchup that kind of sticks out, like a stub toe, where it's like, ooh, they're not as good at this one as the others.
There's a lot of StarCraft players where it's like that, where there's like one problem matchup where they just kind of can't get a handle on it. Some of these matchups,
totally.
It's funny, because in Brood War, some of the matchups operate so differently from each other that it's like entirely different skill sets. I mean, look at how ZVZ works compared to the other matchups that Zerg has to play. And then even ZVP and ZVT are entirely different. Let's see what happens. I think Hero is a safe bet here, but anything could happen. We'll see what kind of builds are going to come out. And our game is ready, guys. This is game two, Hero versus Barracks in Group A of the ASL.
Yes, the first of many Terrans in ASL Season 11. I'm so happy.
Artosis. I could just see Artosis getting ready for the ASL cast, and he's going, feed me!
Yeah.
More Terran builds!
Dude, well, I've suffered through so many seasons of, like, Terrans just not performing, but now we have so many, it's kind of like, you know... It's like one of those armies that attacks a castle, and the reason why they're able to take it is they walk over the bodies of other dead Terrans, you know?
Yeah.
Where it's like there's so many Terrans that I'm like, well, there's going to be a good amount in the round of 16 and then the round of 8 just because they're everywhere.
There was a couple seasons. We had a couple seasons where, like, there were maps. Like, some of these, I think Sparkle was the island map. We had PvPs, and I'm like...
Where Terran won no games.
Yeah, and then when I watched a PvP, I'm like, I guess I've learned you can make Corsairs in a PvP, and that doesn't help me at all.
No, that was a funny one. Sparkle was like that. Sparkle has a very special place in map hell for Brood War.
Oh yeah.
That one will never be.
I don't
forgiven.
Think we're gonna have another tournament with Sparkle in it.
No, probably,
ever again.
Probably not. All right, so Eclipse. I think that this map is really fun and really cool for Terran versus Zerg, and it's very manageable for Terran. You can go for, like, mech-type builds, but I think bioplay is generally considered strong here.
Seems like it.
Yeah, and, like, the third base is very easy for Zerg to get and hold. But it's kind of like you were talking about, where the fourth base for Zerg is always going to be one of the two bases at the bottom right. unless for some reason Terran loses map control, then they can take the one above their third here, like the one that we see at, what, 9:45 or something for Hero. But it'll almost always be towards the bottom right. So you kind of have a very good idea of what Zerg is trying to do as Terran here, which lets you, like, if you get that map control, to maintain it for a pretty long time.
Are there any special rushes you need to watch out for on either side in this matchup on this map?
Well, you know, there's just the kind of the standard stuff, right? Like, it's not like they... You could be far spawns, right? So you have just the regular spawns. So things like Academy rushes can be good. Here we see that it's a wall in from barracks, which is really trendy and popular right now. It just kind of allows you to skip getting a bunker later on. But because of that, you have to watch out. You know, you could have something like a silly lurker play come up and get in your way at that wall. But yeah, nothing in particular here, really.
Does seem like TVZ has gone through so many different evolutions. It's funny because honestly, you know, when GSL Code S first came out, I don't know about you, but I think you're probably in the same boat as me. You probably didn't imagine that StarCraft 1 would have that many more changes, right?
Mm-hmm.
I kind of in my head thought, okay, well, we've figured everything out there was about StarCraft 1, and it was so weird when we came back. I'm like, there was even the periods where, you know, where there was vultures laying mines all over the map in the TVZ, and then you know, we've had
the mech switches were a big thing for a long time. The 5-racks plus one.
Yeah, it's a funny matchup in that sense that there's so many different ways to approach it.
Yeah, there's all sorts of like pure mutalisk builds nowadays and crazy Zerg builds that have been refined. And like, yeah, the matchup has changed dramatically.
So when you see an opening like this from Terran, is there a specific tech that you are forced into? Or is it still pretty ambiguous from the Zerg's perspective Terran's going to do?
Yeah, I mean, it could be like a mech build or a tech build, but yeah, you're kind of watching like how many Marines are being made to figure out that. Like right now you see a third Marine being made, so it's like, okay, that's not really a Vulture, right? So we probably won't see a Sunken Colony go up. Here I would expect, if I'm Hero, that he's going for a quick engineering bay, but we actually see that it is a factory. It's just, basically you're looking at the timing of the command center. If the command center is a timing before gas or after gas, if it's after gas, you have to make a sunken to stop vultures. If it's later than that, then the vulture can't really get there at any reasonable time. So what we're seeing is maybe a 1-1-1 from barracks. Like maybe he's rushing up to like a Valkyrie, a science vessel, a Wraiths possibly. I'd be surprised if he goes into mech from here, but you can, you know, it's not super optimized.
Is the third base a manageable thing to keep on in this matchup?
Mm-hmm.
I know in TVP, a lot of Protosses try to basically strike the Terran as the third base is being taken. Is that so much of a thing here?
No, not really. Oh, wait a minute. Double armory.
Whoa.
Oh, he's a madman. He's not even a thing.
What?
I've literally never seen this.
I've never seen this ever.
So it's a delayed factory, and he's going to send the Vulture out. And I want to see the natural of Hero really badly. Like, I imagine, like, I think he has enough lings that he probably doesn't need to make a sunk,
so
but I think he should.
He just wants to hit it 1-1? Is that the...
That...
Right? That's the only thing this could be.
That's the only thing I can think of. But yeah, he surrounds that first vulture. You see, like, this was not a scary thing. If you go factory first, this vulture can be scary, but here it's like, what, it killed a ling or two. But yeah, with the double armory, it doesn't really... I think you're right. I think it will be a two-base Goliath all-in.
I think that's exactly what it's going to be. Now,
and it's going to be like a very, very fast one, because normally with two-base Goliath all-ins, one armory will get you 1-1, and you'll have basically about 30 Goliaths and 3 siege tanks, and you hit your opponent exactly then. And it's like really sharp. It's like right before Defilers. Here, though, yeah, I don't know. I've just never seen it.
So here's a couple questions I ask myself when I see this. First of all, the original build, if we had were to not have two armories, just one, is just the timing push. Is it 5 factories with Goliaths?
Yeah, if you're doing an all in, or you can go third base with it. Okay. It's like up to you.
But so, what benefit does the armor upgrade give? I mean, obviously, it takes a little bit more time to kill. But is there some special?
Oh yeah, armor upgrade sort of like is actually better against Zerg than attack upgrade these things. Yeah,
okay.
Like it helps out significantly. Like giving a Goliath plus one attack doesn't do much against Zerg units, but plus one armor, it's like they already have an armor, so now two armor against Lings, so Lings do 3 damage, and then like I mean, it's super armor is always good against mutas, right. Whereas the plus attack doesn't really kill mutas that much quicker. It's more about like sustaining. So actually, with most mech builds, you go plus one armor first.
Oh, I didn't know that. Okay.
If you're going two base, you go plus one armor, and if you're going three base, you go plus one attack, because then as you scale up, plus two attack is insane.
Got it. But got it.
So this is actually a lurker build, and this is what I was talking about. When you do a wall, you have to be really careful about stuff like this, because you're not really in position to stop the lurkers. You're going to lose the depots no matter what. But here it's like he's going to have turrets for detection, and that's about it. This could be problematic.
Yeah, Goliaths are not great against Ling Lurker.
Now you can micro him back and like be pretty efficient. God, okay, targets down the first lurk, which is so important. Huge volley. Oh my God. Oh my God. Okay, well, he's losing the Marines, so he can't really bunker up at this point. He's probably starting a siege tank right away. And I got to tell you, the one thing you don't need 1-1 against is this.
Yeah, this is pretty wild. I mean, the lurkers can tear down the barracks, but then they're positioned, yeah, quite nicely to just come in here for a dive. And there's just not a lot of surface area. These Lings even getting in front of the Goliaths.
Oh, man. Like, this is just this is destroying over. Him. Yeah.
This is it.
No, it is.
This is kind of making the Terran look like a fool for even trying this build, you know? He's like, how about I make my guys an attack you build? How about that one? Can the Goliath build stop that? No?
I tell you, man.
Yeah.
I was so excited to see the double armory and see exactly what was coming. Now we'll never really know.
This is the second game we've had today where it's like, well, that seems like it could have been good, but it didn't work out.
Yeah.
Whether it's crawling Reavers or 1-1 Goliath teching. You know, I think if the Zerg had teched into Mutalisks, we would have had a game the Terran would have wanted to have played
yes,
out.
Yes, yes. He wants to hit Mutas there, yeah. 100%.
But, you know, Goliaths, there's a reason why you generally only see them against air units. Is, you know, they're not the best to fight on the ground, compared to tanks or marines or even vultures.
Yeah, they can fight like early on against ground units reasonably well against Zerg, but in a situation like that where we saw that like five lurker volleys hit twice,
yeah.
It's like, oh yeah, well everything's dead, what do you want? Right?
Yeah.
And a big part of that was because of the wall. These builds where you wall in, sometimes lurker gets you.
Yeah.
Sometimes your best laid plans are destroyed by your own wall because you wanted to wall so you wouldn't have to make a bunker.
Yeah, and now
Reed will get you every time.
And so that's our second Zerg win on the board here. Hero crushing barracks back there, which means our winner's match is going to be a ZVZ.
Yeah, and I mean, you shouldn't be too surprised. It's Hero and Effort. So we're going to see that, guys, after this quick commercial break.
달려 뭐해 꽂혔다면 쏟아부어 인생 직진 음료 다시
디자인하면서 가장 중요하게 생각했던 부분은 울트라 기어의 차별화된 브랜드 메시지를 잘 나타내는 것입니다. 신과 영웅들의 최강의 무기들을 검토하였습니다. 그중 니케의 승리의 날개를 모티브로 지금의 울트라 기어의 로고가 탄생하게 되었습니다. 울트라 기어의 이니셜인 U와 G를 비상하는 날개의 형상으로 레드 색상을 사용하여 강력한 에너지와 힘을 나타내었습니다. 울트라 기어는 최상의 퍼포먼스로 진정한 게임의 즐거움, 승리의 기쁨을 여러분께 선사할 것입니다.
아 제발 좀만 더 아 솔드아웃
컴다운 정신 차려 슬퍼할 시간이 어딨어 끝까지 가는 사람이 개 타는 거야, 오케이? 꽂혔다면 쏟아부어! 인생 직진 음료! 핫식스!
고... 성능을 대용량 배터리로 언제 어디서나 더 오래 즐기다. 72Wh 대용량 배터리 고성능 노트북의 새로운 기준 LG 울트라 기어 듀얼 메모리 듀얼 저장 장치 고성능을 듀얼 업그레이드로 더 오랜 기간 즐기다.
이번에 장학금 타면 노트북 지를 수 있어. 그러니까 조금만 더 힘내자. Let's go. 고쳤다면 쏟아부어. 인생 직진 음료. 핫식.
No, we're back. What's up, everybody? We've just had our two best of ones. The Zergs have defeated the aliens and the humans so far.
Yeah. As expected. I was kind of like, the PVZ was fresh and new and really interesting. And then we had that TVZ that looked like it was going to be the same, but it wasn't.
I am a bit sad,
but that's okay. I'll get through it.
Yeah.
We have plenty of Terrans. Yeah. It's just one.
If
one
you want to see
so
that
far.
Build again, it'll be on Artosis' stream, where he'll also be losing in the same way.
Exactly the same way. Oh, God. Well, it's ZVZ time, my friend.
Let's do it, man. I like ZVZ.
Well, let's first talk Ascension. About Ascension.
Named they named this map after your tournament. That was so cool.
I know, I know.
Hey, you get money for that, right?
Tasteless. They fired us from ASL. I don't get anything. Ascension. This map is actually, guys, it's Blue Storm. If you know Blue Storm, the two-player map, it's a legendary Brood War map. And they basically tore it in like apart and duplicated it. It's a three-player Blue Storm. Look at it. Okay, I'm not actually the one drawing these yellow
circles.
Yeah,
this circles. Is Dan. He's trying to get good at circles, but he can only do ovals right now.
I'm trying to draw a very happy UFO, and it's just not working out.
Yeah.
But, it looks really cool to me, Ascension does. Blue Storm is, like, one of the more fun, cooler old maps.
Yeah.
And to see it, like, kind of reimagined as a three-player map, because as a two-player, it's, like, a little bit imbalanced, but it's still a very interesting map. This takes a lot of the same concepts and puts them together, but the fact that there's the third-player location means that it can't just be cut in half easily. And that's one of the best things in general about three-player maps, is some of these maps, you can just cut in half, Like, Eclipse isn't too bad about it, but you, like, you can cut it in half. Blue Storm, you would always see cut in half. This map, Ascension, I don't think so. I don't think that can happen. Now, we are going into ZBZ, so nothing I said matters. There's going to be Lynx and Mutas, but you know.
Who do you think wins this? I think this could go either way. Effort, you think?
Yeah, it's Effort, man. Is he supposed to lose ZBZ to anyone but Jadong?
I don't think so. Guys, we're ready. The winner moves on to the round of 16. Let's get this ZBZ on.
Who's Maytube?
Maytube is Effort. That's a lot of them use IDs. Basically, the trendy thing for StarCraft 1 pros is to name your YouTube channel, like, your nickname and Tube in all caps. And then everyone ladders on Tube accounts. It's, like, really funny.
This is a funny thing is in the Korean language, you can... It's kind of like in German. German, you can hammer together words and kind of make a bigger word.
Mm-hmm.
You can do that in Korean, or I should say Koreans like to do that.
Yeah.
A lot. Although occasionally they'll try doing it with an English word.
They do that a lot.
Yeah. I had a way back before you and I were casting together when I was solo casting, I had a recording at GOM TV and mm-hmm. they had a whole bunch of English words they hammered together. It didn't make any sense.
Oh, that's awesome.
It was like, instead of like having fun, it was like, have fun? Or so, it was a couple of weird ones they gave me and I'm like, we can't use this. And they're like, no, I'm like, trust me.
Yeah.
What you guys think this, if you know, you think this sounds good and it probably does in Korean, it does not work.
Yeah, they have a lot of funny things like that. Like, for instance, they love to call things story out here. And what they do is they hammer whatever it is with the last part of story, which is apparently Tory. So it'll be like if it's a coffee shop, it might be Cough Tory because it's coffee story. Yes. It's like, what? What? That's type of stuff happens all the time.
An example of this in the Korean language is like, you know, they use the word chicken, same word in English for chicken. And then the word for beer is mekju.
Yeah.
And so if you're having chicken and beer, which is a common, evening meal with your friends, they mm-hmm. call that chimek.
Yes.
But we don't, you know, if we get chicken and beer, I don't say, let's have chick beer. You know, it doesn't work.
Chibi.
Chibi.
You want some chibi?
Want chibi? Damn, you know I love my chibi.
Yeah.
So, anyways, that's...
Yeah, there you go, guys.
Combos.
Maytube.
Mm-hmm. Maytube.
Yeah, so it's ZVZ, and it looks like... no circling rushes going on, at least.
That's right. So this is the most restricted matchup, I think, in literally any RTS game.
I think so.
I mean, the Zergling and the Mutalisk are so powerful that everything else is kind of pushed away. High-level ZBZs, of course, end extremely quickly. And in this case, they're both getting expansions and gas, so nobody's really the defender while the other one's the aggressor so far.
Mm-hmm. And, I feel like, I guess, you know, you asked me who I thought was going to win, and I just insta-say Effort. It's because his micro is so, so strong, and it's so important, and he's got that killer instinct, which is one of the most important things for Zerg players, right? Like, micro is very important with Lings and Mutas, especially in this matchup.
Yeah.
But also, you have to be very decisive as a Zerg player, and that's something, like, that Jadong and Effort specifically were super well known for, is how decisive that they are. And, you know, I think that'll help quite a bit. Whereas Hero, I think more of as a macro Zerg, you know?
Yeah, like I would agree.
Yeah, macro Zergs tend to be, like, really robust in a lot of ways, but sometimes have a harder time ZVZ against more aggressive Zergs.
Yeah, I mean, Effort is the kind of guy that can make a very unique situation work for him by just sort of forcing it in there. This is one of the things that you can do more in StarCraft 1 than you can in StarCraft 2 is really out-micro somebody.
Yeah.
Like, really, really, really out-control somebody.
Mm.
Because the path...
Crazy things can happen.
Yeah, the pathing is not clean, and you can... Kind of, the more time you put into microing a unit, the more you'll get out of it.
Mm-hmm.
So in this case, the Link speed's done. He came and put a little bit of pressure on. Some of the Links actually ran past his Zerglings. We should note there's no ramp in between the main and the natural, which...
It's the double egg thing.
It's a double egg thing, and it's a fairly large opening, we should point out here.
Mm-hmm.
So these Lings get through. One Ling will be picked off. He wants to see if he can get any drones.
Yeah, and he might be able to. I mean, they're so fast, these lings, that it really does come down to micro, but see what Hero can do for blocking. And look, he slips them through. Look at that. Like, you can see, like, even things like this takes so much speed and efforts. Micron very well so far. But with that sunk and with this many lings, I'm not sure that he can get that damage.
It's almost caught. This isn't going to do much here. And you do want to think of the Zerglings almost like a resource into themselves. Everything is, you know, this matchup is so tight. You get so few workers. Losing a Ling, an Overlord, a drone, it's a big deal.
Mm-hmm.
So we did have a Sunken Colony made at the natural here for Hero. I don't believe there's anything made. No, there's not. Down here for effort. But I want to see, you know, I think the muters are going to come out a little bit more quickly for Hero here. Am I correct about that?
Yeah, I believe that's the case. We're going to see it. I mean, they both have so many Lings right now, though. It feels like there's going to, like, this should end up deciding it. Let's see. Hero's running down with a lot of Lings. Does pull back, just still making Lings. Mining a lot of gas, though.
There is a trick where you can, you know, as they're anticipating probably 5 to 6 muters coming, you can actually just keep making Lings and kind of throw them off and hit them.
Yeah,
getting, you know,
if they're hatching larva. 5 mutas, that's 10 more Lings that you might have, right?
Right.
And then the muta build time, too, takes a while. And, yeah, you might be able to bludgeon your way through. Now, here we go. Hero is actually going to attack into Effort. Effort has a very good concave here. And I think Effort's going to just barely hold this.
Yeah, Effort seems like he's probably fine. There's some more Lings hatching here. These three are going to run in. Let's see if he can get a drone kill.
Yeah, I think he'll get one at least.
Yeah.
There goes down one.
Three Lings can snipe a drone pretty fast.
Oh, yeah.
Let's see if we can get this next one over here.
Oh. Wow, I'm actually surprised he didn't get the second one there. It looked like he was going to, but the mutas come out and finally do get him. Now, we have 4 mutas here from Hero going across the map. Looks like a little Ling counterattack running by that Sunken Colony for Effort, that makes the mutas turn around.
Yeah, they're going to have to come back here and try to defend. They do not actually get any of these drones. Oh, he's got a... It's
actually...
The Lings are camouflaged on the map because they're blue.
it's actually incredibly hard to target quickly moving units that juke around.
Yeah.
It's, like, kind of crazy.
Yeah, no, I have that when I'm trying to kill Lings in my base.
Yes.
I'm like, I just can't actually click on these things.
Yeah.
So, I think things have slowed down a little bit here. We have mutas building up on both sides. Now, a couple of unique factors we got to point out. A, no spores. On either side.
Yeah.
So if you leave your base, you're at risk of their mutas coming in there and hitting you first. But it does seem like a Hero has a little bit more of the initiative on the map. It seems like Effort's a little bit more on his back foot. But you have 2 locations you're defending. If you're defending your main, they can hit your natural with mutas and vice versa. So here comes a very important moment here. Effort has to control this perfectly. And this is a lot of Scourge.
Yeah, it seems like Hero just has more at the moment, but let's see if Effort's micro can help out. We also do have his hatches closer, but it looks like Hero just has more. He has like 3 or 4 more mutas here. Now, another one does pop, as well as some Scourge, but Effort not able to connect. Hero getting some value there.
Yeah, the multitasking with the micro in these moments is so important. It's very difficult to pull everything off. The idea is that you have the Scourge come out. The mutas have to run from that, so they have to moving shot away while you're still going to target down their units. But I will tell you this, if Effort doesn't handle this next engagement well, he will lose the game.
He needs to hit a lot of Scourge upon these mutas if he's going to be able to win this game, and I don't think that's going to be doable. Look at the amount of Scourge coming after him as well, and a lot of them do connect. Some good micro there from Hero. Does take a couple Scourge hits, but his Mutalisk flock is so much larger.
Yeah, he just has too much more here, and I think that is going to be it. He has won this game. GG in an excellent muta engagement. You know, it's funny, not often in any RTS game is being able to micro one unit the most important thing. In this game, it is. This is the case. He controlled his mutas better.
Yeah, Mutalisk micro is a big part of it. He did have that slight muta lead that you mentioned as well,
right?
Where he got his mutas a little bit quicker. He was a little bit ahead on him. And his micro was good enough to hold on to that. So we are going to be going to a little interview with Hero in a moment here. But Hero advancing in first place, I don't think it's like super surprising.
No.
Yeah, Effort is a legend in Zerg versus Zerg overall. But these are 2 of the best Zergs out there. And, you know, one of them was going to advance in first place.
Yeah, and I mean, I don't think Effort's chances of advancing are that hindered either.
No, I think he's favored against the other 2 guys still, for sure.
Yeah. So Effort has you know, lost that. He'll be facing off against the survivor of the losers match, which we're going to be going to in a little bit here. So we're going to have that interview now with Hiro, see how he's feeling, have a short break, and then come back into this next game.
Yeah, I can't wait. Another Terran game. All right, here's that interview. Almost.
Almost. Wait for it.
Come on.
Somebody get Hiro to this interview.
ASL 시즌 11 24강 개막전 경기 함께하고 계십니다. 가장 먼저 16강에 진출한 선수가 탄생했는데요. 조일장 선수 만나보겠습니다. 축하드립니다.
아, 감사합니다.
오늘 정말 완벽한 준비를 해오신 게 아닌가 싶을 정도로 이렇게 빠르게 16강에 진출을 하셨습니다. 먼저 준비해온 대로 경기가 잘 풀린 소감이 어떠신지 듣고 싶어요.
일단 솔직히 이렇게 2승으로 제가 1등으로 진출을 할 줄은 몰랐는데 확실히 연습을 많이 안 한 게 도움이 됐던 것 같아요.
연습을 많이 안 한 게 도움이 됐다라고 말씀을 하셨는데 황병영 선수와의 경기에서는 입구를 뚫어버리는 빌드를 준비해 오신 것 같더라고요. 네. 그럼 머릿속으로 계속 이미지 트레이닝을 좀 하셨던 건가요?
일단은 좀 연습을 많이 할수록 저는 이상하게 경기력이 안 좋아지더라고요. 그래가지고 그냥 컨디션 관리에 최대한 신경 쓰면서 그냥 상대 보면서 그냥 그때그때 제가 생각나는 대로 해보자 그렇게 생각했는데 오늘 좀 잘 맞아 떨어진 것 같아요.
팬분들이 조일장 선수가 경기에서 이렇게 승부를 보는 빌드를 보여준 적이 있나 싶을 정도로 굉장히 오늘은 좀 조일장 선수가 한층 더 진화한 듯한 느낌을 받았다라고 말씀하셨어요.
네.
준비하면서 좀 어떠셨어요? 불안하지 않으셨어요?
일단 좀 뭔가 확신에 찬 뚫기였긴 해요. 좀 하면서도 그냥 끝나지 않을까 이런 생각으로 러쉬를 하면서도 또 막혀도 뭐 괜찮을 것 같아가지고 네, 상황을 좀 잘 만들어놔가지고 네, 좋았던 것 같아요.
승자전은 저그 대 저그가 될 거라고 좀 예상을 하셨을 것 같아요.
네.
준비는 좀 어떻게 해오셨나요?
사실 저그 대 저그전도 진짜 한 판도 안 했어요. 그냥 빌드만 아 정우가 뭐 하려나 계속 빌드만 생각하면서 그냥 컨디션만 잘 관리해서 당일날 잘하면 되지 이 생각으로 했더니 잘 됐네요.
뮤탈을 조금 더 빨리 뽑아서 좀 더 유리하게 뮤탈 싸움을 해야겠다라고 좀 머릿속으로 구상을 해오셨던 건가요?
네, 일단 좀 빌드랑 정찰이 좀 안 좋아가지고 좀 어렵지 않을까 생각했는데 상대 저글링 러시 잘 맞고 나니까 상황이 오히려 좋더라고요. 그래가지고 이대로 뮤탈 싸움 가면은 승산이 있지 않을까 생각했었어요.
지난 시즌 10에서도 조일장 선수 16강에 올라가긴 했습니다만 16강에서 좀 안타까운 탈락이 있었잖아요.
네.
이번 시즌은 또 한 번 높은 곳을 바라보셔야 할 것 같아요. 팬들도 많은 기대를 하고 계실 것 같은데요. 한 말씀 부탁드립니다.
일단 진짜 제가 얼마 전까지만 해도 이번 시즌 ASL 11은 진짜 높은 곳까지 올라가 봐야겠다 이렇게 생각했었는데 그렇게 생각하자마자 또 귀신같이 안 되더라고요. 그래서 그냥 마음 편히 그냥 뭐 마음 편히 그냥 해보려고요.
조일장 선수가 이번 시즌 본인이 어떤 목표치를 설정할지 좀 시즌이 지속되면서 좀 궁금해질 것 같은데요. 다음에도 멋진 경기 기대하도록 하겠습니다. 인터뷰 고맙습니다.
감사합니다.
자, 이렇게 해서 24강 가장 먼저 16강에 올라선 조일장 선수 만나봤고요. 저는 잠시 후에 오늘의 두 번째 진출자와 함께 돌아오겠습니다.
하면 노트북 지를 수 있어. 그러니까 조금만 더 힘내자. Let's go. 꽂혔다면 쏟아부어. 인생 직진 음료. 핫식.
고. 성능을 언제 어디서나 가볍게 즐기다. 지포스 GTX 1650 그래픽 최신 인텔 10세대 프로세서 탑재.
고성능 노트북의 새로운 기준 LG 울트라 기어.
조금만 바로 내일이 치팅데이다. 내일이다 내일 내일 모레도 아니고 내일이다.
꽂혔다면 쏟아부어. 인생 직진 음료 하식.
이상한데? 그렇게 작아.
너무 안 보이는데?
보이지가 않잖아. 쓸 수
아니 저 키워보라고. 고
17대 화면으로 언제 어디서나 더 크게 즐기다. WQXGA 초고화질의 17대 화면, 16:10 최적의 화면비, 고성능 노트북의 새로운 기준 LG 울트라 기어.
Welcome back, everybody. ASL Group A continues on. We're going to go to the losers match now and eliminate our first StarCraft player in the tournament.
Yeah, Hidden Track and Ascension have both been banned, so it's going to be Ultimate Stream coming up. Now, these are some maps that we don't really know all that well, so we're going to be learning alongside you guys. I'm very excited about that. It's great to have new maps. But yeah, let's see. It's going to be Terran versus Protoss. It's going to be Barracks against Sins.
I don't know what this is going to look like with these two.
Yeah.
They also came in here with both of them with very odd builds in the other matchups.
Yeah, they really
Considering
did.
Considering it's a
they
best
really
of one.
Did.
Yeah.
Well, like I said, like Barracks is always really cutting edge. So the fact that he showed two armories, I'm like, am I going to start seeing two armory builds? Like, I don't, I bet yeah, you I will. I bet you I will. Because he's always got really fresh new stuff. So that must be something meta. Anyways, here's Ultimate Stream, guys. I don't really know much about the map. It's four player. The main natural layout looks a lot like Match Point. The way that it's like on that flat ground type area, it's very long with a small choke into your natural. But then you've got a ramp right there. I saw like a couple pros like playing some matches on their streams on this map, but that's about it.
Yeah, I mean, let's see what kind of game we have here. TVP coming into this. You know, whenever you have this matchup, it's important to kind of take a look at the middle of the map, see how pushable it is. You know, Protoss and the Terran, what kind of terrain are you dealing with?
And you can see here, they're like circling the expansions there in the center, which are very interesting expands. The ramps to get in are more towards the center rather than towards the bases, which are going to make it a little bit harder to get up there and defend it properly. But once you have that middle area, I could see that being very powerful. That being said, it looks to me like a very good map for speed shuttles, which is very in vogue right now. Protoss versus Terran anyways.
We've had a revolution in PvT. Speed shuttle play with Psystorm into oftentimes a later Arbiter, sometimes even Carrier. It's crazy to see how this game keeps evolving and how it keeps changing, man. It looks like our game is ready to go. This is Sins versus Barracks. Remember, the loser is out of the ASL.
I'm excited, Tasteless. Top left, we have Sins, Storm Egg, aka Cannon Egg, and then we have Barracks down in the bottom left.
Or Barracks, as I like to call it.
Barracks! Barracks, the 48th Terran of the United States of America.
That's right. When he wins, I'm like, more like Barracks Obama. Wait.
Barracks Obama.
Barracks Obama, sorry.
Yeah. Barracks.
Suddenly, I couldn't. I was like, who was the president's name?
Who was the president's name? Yeah. All right. I mean, I feel like, you know, a positional advantage is something important to note for the map.
Okay.
And it looks like positionally, I like this a little bit more for Barracks. Because notice how it's rotationally symmetric, right? The natural of Barracks that he just came out of with this SCV is pointed towards the main base of Sins. So the thing is, you have a very long base, right? It's stretched out. Which makes things, oh wow, if Ford like 8 or 9 racks, that's crazy. I'll talk about that in 1 second, but like,
yeah,
I was just gonna say that like this drops would be really good, especially if you had the whole side of their base open to you like this, if they were in reverse spawns, for instance. But anyways, that is a very quick barracks in the center, and you know what this made me think of? Do you remember the map Katrina?
Okay, so this is what I was waiting to say. Yeah. This reminds me
a lot. Too bad I already said it.
Yeah. This is, if you have a normal game on this map, you know, Katrina, you could go 2 base carrier pretty effectively. Mm-hmm. Off of pretty much nothing, by the way.
Yeah, yeah.
It was like you have like 4 Dragoons, you're like, time to make carriers.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I wonder if we're going to have a lot of ideas like that happening here. Now, this time around, it's going to be, I believe, 2 barracks in the middle of the map.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry. I thought the other SCV was going to make another barracks somewhere else.
Yeah, it looks like he's scouting with that one, but he's looking to kill a Nexus first, perhaps.
Correct.
But unfortunately for him, it's just a gateway, no gas. So the odds of him taking any damage, since taking any damage, is very, very low, I would say. Whereas if he did go Nexus first, maybe you just get a win.
Yeah, I think he wanted to just kind of steal the game.
Yeah.
With that rush. But, you know, this is what happens. Protoss, they don't have to ever go Nexus first. They can, but they're never forced into doing that. And so
anytime you have a ramp like that leading up, it's so much harder. You can't really do like a Marine SCV push up a ramp.
Yeah,
it's
or
like,
do a 2-factory rush. It's like,
it's so much harder to make any of that work.
High
so.
Ground is king in Brood War. Like, there's just,
it's so powerful.
It's so much more powerful than it is in StarCraft 2. And so, yeah, what exactly does Terran want to do now? Obviously, his plans didn't work out. You know, where does the game go from here?
I think you simply expand. That's it, right?
Okay.
Like, he's made 3 Marines, so he can take out this Zealot, targeting it down. That's actually great, micro with the probe. That actually screws up the math a lot. So this, he does have to come in, fight a little bit. Oh, and now he's shooting low ground against high ground. So he actually missed a couple shots there. He will clean this up. But, yeah, again, because this is a map with a ramp up to the natural like that, you can do, like, for instance, you can just build a bunker here, and they can't really break up it, right? Because they won't have vision with Dragoons to pummel it. So definitely you want to just take and expand.
So I do want to point out one thing, just as an idea that Protosses have when they rush here. Although Terran can both heal infantry units and repair SCVs and mechanical units, when this attack happens, you think of every hit as permanent damage.
Yes. You're never going to go for a medic here unless you're doing a weird all-in.
And
but
the SCVs are not going to be repairing each other. So, you know, if Terran, it's a unique situation where if Terran missteps at all, it's completely punished.
Yes.
And the Zealot is just a stronger unit by multitudes.
Yeah.
Compared
to
the Marine.
And you can actually see that, right? There was just a little bit of miss micro at the ramp at the beginning, and it snowballs.
Yeah.
Whereas if you micro, like, perfectly against the first Zealot, you crush something like this. Like, it eventually they just have to turn around, right? But here, it's a bit tough. Looks like that SimCity does not really work for him to run through. That's kind of funny one. I've never even seen that one.
Yeah, can you actually fit through there with a Marine?
You can fit between 2 depots, but because the command center is there, I think it's a tricky click to do. You might need to move command click onto the thing or something.
This is going just perfectly right now for the Protoss. I mean, he's basically stopped the development over here. As long as the Terran is scrambling to defend in the main, and these CC's not done, the bunker's not done, this is just going to keep going.
Yeah, this is like, it's 3 Zealots against 3 Marines, 2 of which are red, and SCVs that have been pulled. This is he's basically dead, honestly.
Even a lower rank Protoss player can probably play the game from here, and this is really punishing because the Terran took a risk and made a barracks in the middle of the map.
Yeah, he wanted to get like basically a free win against a Nexus first or close to it, right?
Right, and I mean, these Marines, you know, you see them, they're coming from the middle of the map trying to get here into the main. They're coming the same direction the Zealots are, and again, every hit is permanent damage, SCV or Marine. And the shields will regen over time. I mean, they don't come that fast, but it's so bad for the Terran.
Well, right now he's trying to buy time to get out like a vulture, but eventually a dragoon's gonna come, and he needs to put Marines in a bunker at his ramp. And like, he hasn't been mining forever. He's lost a ton of SCVs. You know that Sins is making probes nonstop.
Right. And here's the real nail in the coffin. When the dragoon gets here, it's 4 dragoon hits to kill a Marine.
Yeah, and it's 3 full health Marines to kill a non-range dragoon.
Right, and then
and
when the range comes, it's even worse.
It's infinity. It's like it comes out of micro from the Protoss.
And so, this is one of these kind of weird maneuvers that you have in the game where you get just ahead enough with the Zealots that the Dragoon is like the trump card, basically. There's just not a lot you can do. 20 health on that Marine. This Dragoon will two-shot that Marine and finish him off.
Mm-hmm. And the Marine's coming in from the side. I mean,
there's just...
This is really bad. Now, he pushes him down the ramp and then flanks with two Marines. So, I mean, two Marines and a Vulture can kill a Dragoon, too. So he will have to pull back finally. And I think if Barracks makes a bunker, he's technically held. But he's so far behind, as you can see. Look at the supplies.
Right.
25 to 48. I mean, the SCV count is brutally low. He's got five supply in army, which means he's got 22 SCVs between two bases. That's terrible. At 6 minutes, 50 seconds, you should have, like, 35 SCVs. He's got 22.
No, I mean, the real story is the number of SCVs that were killed. The fact that the command center was finished oh so late.
Yeah.
And it's going to be a Reaver drop from here. And I think this is, you know, you don't have to go Reavers, but, you know, Reavers are so popular now. And it seems like speed shuttles are just getting better every month. And this is another problem.
That's a good
one. Oh, the missed shot. Okay, it doesn't matter. The funny thing about when you see Dragoons fighting Vultures is a Dragoon in the red still actually has a lot of hit points.
Oh, yeah.
When you're watching these fights. Like Vultures destroy Zealots, but...
Vultures have concussive damage, so they barely deal damage to a Dragoon.
Yeah, it's one of these funny things, because when you watch it, it's like, it's almost like the Dragoons don't even have to fight. Oh, that's
you. There you go.
Yeah.
Okay, well, he got mines out, which is, like, pretty good, but a Reaver is going to come. If he had, like, a starport, I'd give him some sort of comeback potential, but he's got one factory, and he's, like, frantically laying mines against Dragoons on his ramp.
Yeah. Yeah, this is going to probably be the killing blow. Basically, Terran took a risk, Protoss punished, and we're about to be in the third sequence of this rush. Mm-hmm. The Reaver coming down here. The Vultures had to be squeezed out because the threat was so real that he didn't have time to get a tank. And when the Reaver comes, you know, the Zealots can beat the Marines, the Dragoons can beat the Marines and the Vultures, and then the Reaver can then beat the Marines, the Vultures, and the tanks.
Yeah.
Until you have, you know, enough with siege mode and a secured area. And
he right now, you need, like, three tanks with siege mode plus a turret to hold this.
Yeah.
And it's just, he does not, he's just dead. We're just waiting for Barracks to GG here, unfortunately.
Beautiful game from the Protoss, punishing the Terran for taking the risk. No quick Nexus.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, we're seeing a lot of risk-taking for best of ones, guys.
Yeah.
You know,
I mean,
if you're better, if you think you're better than your opponent, you might want to just stick to your guns and play safe.
Well, honestly, I mean, Barracks and Sins are probably pretty similar levels, so I don't mind something like this. Maybe he feels... like that, he sees so many Nexus first on that map that's a fair build. Like, he probably looks at it and says 60% of the time it's Nexus first.
Yeah.
And honestly, because he can go back and make a bunker, if they don't even make a Zealot first, then you're totally fine and just expand anyway.
Yeah.
So I think that's not a bad build, but this time it got super punished. So that's it. Barracks is out of the tournament. That's one Terran down.
Our first dead ASL player. Now it's going to be down to effort here. Going up against
Effort versus Sins, the rematch.
Now, I don't think this is going to look like the last game, but I'm open for anything, really. Sins is clearly ready to have some pretty creative play. So let's see what happens, guys. Short break. When we come back, our final game in Group A.
Never mind.
We're back.
we thought
we were going to go. They went to the casters.
Yeah. They're coming up next. But you know what?
We were not ready for that.
No, we weren't ready
at
all.
How different our sizes are. Go back a little bit. If I go this much further forward, I can draw a little, like, take a pencil and put little lines here and turn you into a ventriloquist doll.
Yeah. Oh, my God.
So, guys, I guess we're going to be going to a break in a second. That's weird because they had to, like, this game's coming up next, and they cut to the casters and the Blazers, and I'll tell you what, we really lucked out not getting hired for this for this season with those highlighter Blazers.
Yeah, oh my God. But
I'm liking our mango theme here for ASL.
This at least shows you guys one thing that a lot of people have been asking, because we are releasing these as VODs. Will we know anything ahead of time?
No.
Will that affect the cast? We know nothing. We don't check any websites. We're literally not... which is killing me inside a little bit because I want to watch the games immediately.
But
we have absolutely no idea what's going on. And I'm just pressing the buttons as things come. So here we are.
Oh, I know what they're doing. I see. Can you put them back on camera?
Yes, I sure can, Tasteless.
The Hot 6 segment that we've dodged out on ever having to do, where they chug an energy drink on camera. Look at Castor Park.
Hot 6!
Now look at that. He actually matches the can.
Oh, yeah. It's too bad they don't have yellow cans yet. That would have worked out just perfectly.
Something about Korea and the Blazers they pick for the people on TV.
Yeah, no, I know.
Actually, when
we first got here, they were trying to put us into a lot of funny colors and stuff.
Yeah.
Tasteless had to put his foot down.
There were a lot of awkward conversations in the back room.
Which made me feel bad, because I think I would look fantastic in a yellow blazer.
It looks pretty good, Tasteless. You don't like the color yellow? Yeah. No, there was a lot of... you're just going to have to find another blazer. We're not going to go on TV. we eventually won that fight. I like what they give us for GSL in the past ASLs.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, we're going to go to commercial.
This is not a drill. Oh. Commercial time. Go, go.
Designer하면서 가장 중요하게 생각했던 부분은 울트라 기어의 차별화된 브랜드 메시지를 잘 나타내는 것입니다. 신과 영웅들의 최강의 무기들을 검토하였습니다. 그중 니케의 승리의 날개를 모티브로 지금의 울트라 기어의 로고가 탄생하게 되었습니다. 울트라 기어의 이니셜인 U와 G를 비상하는 날개의 형상으로 레드 색상을 사용하여 강력한 에너지와 힘을 나타내었습니다. 울트라 기어는 최상의 퍼포먼스로 진정한 게임의 즐거움, 승리의 기쁨을 여러분께 선사할 것입니다.
아 제발 좀만 더. 아 솔드아웃.
컴다운, 정신 차려. 슬퍼할 시간이 어디 있어? 끝까지 가는 사람이 개 타는 거야, 오케이? 고쳤다면 쏟아부어. 인생 직진 음료.
성능을 대용량 배터리로 언제 어디서나 더 오래 즐기다. 72Wh 대용량 배터리, 고성능 노트북의 새로운 기준, LG 울트라 기어. 듀얼 메모리, 듀얼 저장 장치, 고성능을 듀얼 업그레이드로 더 오랜 기간 즐기다.
이번에 장학금 타면 노트북 지를 수 있어. 그러니까 조금만 더 힘내자. Let's go. 고쳤다면 쏟아부어. 인생 직진 음료. 핫식.
Like that music that was playing earlier, look at what you've done. And I want to have to play it when the Terran makes the barracks in the middle of the map. It's like, look at what you've done.
Oh, man. All right. For this final match, it looks like Fighting Spirit and Polaris Rhapsody have been vetoed. We're going to be going to Polypoid, one of the greatest maps
out there. Let's do it. Polypoid. I actually really like Polypoid.
Polypoid is a fantastic
map. I will tell you, when I first saw
that's my go-to map right now.
I got nervous when I first saw it. It was one of those maps where I thought, oh, this might be really hard to play on. It seems kind of like open and there's... I think it's great.
It felt a little bit hard at first for me, but when I got used to it, I'm like, oh, this is just beautiful. It's such an interesting map.
Yeah, I really am glad that there's some great maps coming out.
Yeah. Yeah, it doesn't feel like... I think map quality is going up right now, which is insane, because there used to be like 4 or 5 full-time, my job is making maps, map makers. So the fact that we have like some of the best maps ever coming out right now is... Yeah. Amazing.
Yeah, yeah. No, well, I think it's great that we have some pretty eccentric experimental maps, but I think it's also really good that we are still producing very solid maps that have a few creative points inside them. Mm-hmm. Like Eclipse, for instance, I think is an excellent map.
Yeah, that's a great one.
Polypoid as well.
All right. This is the final match, Tasteless. Effort against Sins. Is there any chance he does that beautiful Reaver build again?
1000% no. It's never coming back.
Is there any chance we see carriers?
No, Artosis.
Is there nothing fun here at all?
No, there's going to be a lot of fun, but there's
I thought it's a game. Don't we play games for fun, Tasteless?
No, we play games because we want to get better at games.
That's the right answer.
There's no way.
I've never been so proud of you in my life, Tasteless.
Did I do it? No, there's no way he's going to do that. We may have some kind of Reaver play, but I think the crawling Reaver play, unique to Eclipse, didn't work out. To be honest with you, I want to see some more pros do that to see if we can unpack it a little bit more. Mm-hmm. You know, a lot of the casting we do is us, you know, going back to the knowledge we've had of the past and how certain matchups have grown and are treated. But every once in a while, we get a game like our first two where we're like, I've never seen this before in my life.
No, it's so sick. And I mean, I keep very up on StarCraft, but I haven't seen the double armory build yet. And I don't know if I ever will again, but I hope so. Either way, I'm very interested in that heavy Reaver play from Sins. I think you're right. It's Polypoid. It's too big a map. That's not going to be as likely.
Yeah, I mean, this is generally just a map. The Protoss is going to either gate expand or forge expand. There are some cannon rushes you can do. We might have that. Well, anyways, it looks like our game's ready to do this, guys. It's the last game of the night. Effort versus Sins, a PBZ, and a fight to survive to the round of 16 of the ASL. I do like the color theme here.
Yeah, it's excellent.
Yeah.
It goes right with the Korean Blazers.
Yeah, yeah. The what happened is they bought those Blazers first, and then they colored the whole tournament this later on.
Oh, that's love that idea.
Yeah,
something that stupid.
They bought Mango Blazers and were like, listen, can we just make everything, like, you know, hot yellow?
Yeah.
For this tournament?
Love it. I love it. All right, Polypoid. We have in the top right Effort, in the bottom left Sins, so cross spawns. What do we need to know about cross spawns in this matchup on this map?
I mean, this should be a long PBZ.
All right.
Unless something happens. Cross spawn. I mean, the couple things to note. I mean, the Zerg can expand in two different directions, mm-hmm. so Protoss has to watch for that, of course. Protoss also doesn't have to fight to get a main. You know, you can basically take... You can get up to 5 bases just in your quadrant on the map. Late game, if you're in cross spots, it's true on several maps, it's also true on Polypoid, is that it's not as easy for a Zerg to just steal a main and hold out for the rest of the game, but it does happen. And I mean, we'll see. I don't think we'll have a Hydra bus. It's a pretty long travel distance to go for.
Now that you said that about like taking another, you know, like your third base is like another natural and then taking the main behind that was really popular like a few years ago. But now that I think about it, I don't think I've ever seen it on Polypoid. Is it just something that has trended away in general on 4-player maps, or is Polypoid specifically bad for it?
No, I don't think Polypoid is specifically bad for it. You mean where they take their natural and then they take the other natural?
Yes. So they can just like turtle up. Remember Larva and Solki did that a lot a few years ago. Like they were killing Protosses with that.
Well, it seems like back then a lot of Protosses tried to just fight through that and it didn't work.
But, yeah.
It just seems like Protosses have gotten a lot better at kind of handling that stuff.
I think you're right. We did see that a lot where it's like you would just attack, move into it over and over, and then you get flanked and that's it.
Yeah, I mean, occasionally you'll see people do it. I mean, this is kind of a common cheese opener on the ladders. You do that into the Hydra Bust, and it just sort of throws the Protoss off.
Oh, yeah.
You know, your expansion behavior is telegraphing late game, but then you just rush and attack them.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, we'll see if it comes back into style. But yeah, you're right. That was a play, kind of the guaranteed fourth base play.
All right. Well, he does end up scouting here. Does have that gateway as well. The first Zealot coming across the map for Sins. And, I mean, everything looks pretty normal here.
Yeah, so the first Zealot is going to come out here. If you can with the probe, you want to try to stop the drone from making the third hatch. It doesn't look like that's going to happen.
Mm.
This is, you know, all the pros... You'll have a different, you know, hiding spot for their Zealot. Sometimes, if you see more than like sixlings or more, then you send the Zealot back oftentimes because you realize this is no longer about trying to come in here and do any harass.
Your harass was already done in via making the Zerglings.
Yeah, yeah. You're playing a different game. And, you know, Sins has the right idea. Two or three probes here to help keep the ramp under control. And I am flabbergasted. I can't believe that Link got in.
I can't believe the other Link got away, like, as well.
Yeah. That somehow the fact that both Links were not killed there is astounding to me.
Yeah.
It's not the end of the world, but that is unfortunate. Mm. You know, you want to try to control this as best you can. So we're going to have the gas and the forge come down here momentarily. You know, the problem when you have the one Ling that's in there is you have to send something in there to kill that, and sometimes they can just spring a big Ling attack. In fact, I think we're going to have it this time around.
There are quite a few Lings being made.
There are these all-ins that are becoming extremely popular where they just kill your gate.
I have seen, you know, some of that lately, yeah.
Yeah, where it's like... How do I say this? The controlling side for the Protoss in the rush is harder.
Mm-hmm.
The Lings are... like the most responsive unit in the game, basically. You can, if you're really microing a Ling, you can do so much with
more,
it.
More responsive than Hydras?
Oh, no. Nothing's more responsive than that. But
are they more responsive than Mutas, though?
No.
Oh, okay. So Zerg has all the most responsive units.
That is absolutely correct.
Okay, yeah. I'm just wanting to make sure about that.
The probe, it's funny. It's a great unit against Terran. It's hard to micro against Lings. Like, the Ling is just better. Mm-hmm. And the Zealot, look, a Zealot can beat a Zergling, but the Zealot's not a fast unit.
Yeah.
Right? And so you're kind of at the whims of the Zerg. And so we do have these rushes where they basically just, if they kill the gate, they can just get in there. And it's really hard. We'll even see, like, the best of the best, like Bisou, just kind of get mowed down by that. This is basically a Protoss opening gone bad.
Mm-hmm.
It's not the end of the world. I mean, it's certainly a game that Protoss could win. But when you have the Lings in your base, it's a headache.
Four speedlings in your base does not feel very good, that's for sure, especially when it's effort.
And whether you kill these probes or not, you're stopping them from mining.
Yeah.
It is kind of insane to the uninitiated how much you lose every time those probes are stopped. And this is the problem.
God.
He's actually beating me to my explanation.
Oh, my God.
Because you have to plug that entrance, the Lings can run back in, kill the cannon, and...
Tasteless. You promised me a long game here.
I know. I really dropped the ball this time. But look, this is what goes down. And keep in mind, behind this is a Hydra Bust. Every bit of damage on the gateway is important because these Hydras are going to blow that thing up so fast. First of all, this cannon has to finish. It's actually not made in the best spot. He had to throw it down somewhere.
Oh, two Lings put off onto the cannon, bringing it solo. Oh my God, that one Ling actually kills it.
By the way, was I wrong about this? The cannon takes the same amount of damage when it's making as when it's done.
Takes like 20 times more damage.
It always feels like when you watch it getting attacked, it's like, wow, that thing is just never going to finish.
Yeah, it's so low.
And so behind this is the Hydra attack, and this is where the attack could go from damaging to fatal.
Yeah, you know, by the way, on that, I think what it is cannons have a long build time compared to their health. So it looks like that, you know?
I think you're probably right.
Yeah, it just looks like it's taken massive damage because you know how much health a cannon has, but it's like, nah, it takes a long time. But I don't know, man. I've never attacked a cannon before it warped in. I'm a Terran player.
Yeah, that's something a Terran player doesn't get to experience. No. But
Okay, a lot of Hydra is actually coming down against like one cannon, but he has enough Zealots. I feel like he's not going to die right here.
Well, the problem is that the Zealots are slow Zealots. They're behind the gate.
Not for long when that gate dies. Yeah,
this gate is going to be gone very quickly. He wants to actually kill the Forge. That's most important. Mm. And there's only three cannons. And the problem is with slow Zealots, even if Sins gets a fourth cannon up, and I think that's what started just above the pylon, like, you know, Hydras are just better. You know, he's going to get the pylon. He's going to open this up.
He's going to five. And look at that. Yeah, gets right on top of the Hydras as they come in. And that cannon actually lives. Okay, it does get picked off as a Hydra goes forward.
Now, what he's doing is he's having a certain number of the Hydras target the cannon. This is so funny. It's the second time he's not lost that.
That probe actually going around for the flank, like trying to stop the Hydras a little bit there. And you can see how buff those Zealots are, kind of buying enough time for more cannons warping.
Yeah, they bought time. There's only one more Zealot here, though. He's going to go for this one cannon in the front. It will die only firing three or four shots. And the problem is, I think we are at the tipping point here. I mean, the gateway is going to go down. There's no more Zealots coming for a while, unless the gate's done in the main. And this, when this cannon goes down, it's basically ensured that the Zerg is going to win. And again, this all goes back in a butterfly effect moment to that those Lings getting in the main.
Yeah.
That's PvZ early game. It's very difficult. You've got to guard your ramp. You've got to cork your entrance. And you better be ready for a Hydra bust if it's coming. One of the best rushes in the game, the Hydra bust.
Oh, no, totally. He really killed him with that. I think that it was all reactive from effort, too. I don't think he went into Polypoid thinking, oh, I'm just going to kill him with a Hydra bust. I think it really had a lot to do with how his Zealots didn't really do that much, and the Lings ran by and got in, and remember the first Ling got in, and he screwed him up so many times that it felt like, you know, he could just add more weight to it.
Right. I mean, basically, it all goes back to that first Ling slowing stuff down. You get to kill the cannons over and over. You're losing minerals. You're not teching into anything that can stop this, and the Hydras just kill you. So a straightforward game. I guarantee you effort didn't come into that game deciding he was going to do a Hydra rush. And in fact, I think it was quite the opposite. I think after the first Ling got in, he said, okay, I think we have the right building blocks in the picture to set up a rush. And there it is. That's PvZ sometimes. You've got to be ready, and you have to be able to deal with the Lings, or you're never going to get to the tech you need to then win a game.
Yeah. And, you know, it's tough to see. I mean, these two Zergs are just absolute killers. What? Quick interview.
24강 개막전 경기 모두 함께 하셨습니다. 16강에 올라간 두 번째 선수는 역시 적은 김정우 선수인데요. 김정우 선수 만나보겠습니다. 축하드립니다.
아, 감사합니다.
네, 3년여 만에 돌아온 ASL 승리한 모습으로 팬들에게 인사를 드릴 수 있게 됐습니다. 16강 진출하신 소감 어떠세요?
일단은 제가 ASL 포인트가 높더라고요. 그래서 주편성이 이제 다른 선수들에 비해서 이제 좀 쉬운 편으로 잡혔다고 생각을 했어요. 그래가지고 올라가게 돼서 굉장히 다행이고, 예, 아까 말했던 대참사가 안 일어나서 다행인 것 같습니다.
근데 원지훈 선수와 오늘 두 번의 경기를 펼치셨는데 첫 번째 경기에서는 원지훈 선수가 굉장히 독특한 좀 경기 전략을 가지고 왔습니다. 걸어다니는 리버가 정말 저글링처럼 많았어요.
네네.
이런 양상을 사실 경기하면서 많이 못 접하셨을 것 같은데 어떠셨어요, 그 경기는?
사실 연습하면서도 저런 이제 전략은 당해보질 않았는데 원지훈 선수가 이제 제가 좀 당황하길 바라고 하신 것 같아요. 근데 제가 당황하지 않고 좀 잘 대처했던 게 이길 수 있었던 것 같습니다.
조일장 선수와의 저조전 승자전에서는 이 뮤털 싸움에서 안타깝게 좀 패배를 했잖아요. 그 경기 이후에는 좀 그 경기를 복귀하는데 어떤 좀 생각을 하셨나요?
사실 그냥 저그대저그전 좀 연습 때도 잘 안 되더라고요. 그래서 일장에도 잔한 선수가 그냥 조금 비우고 왔는데 좀 아쉬웠지만 그래도 최종전 남아 있으니까 최종전 이겨야겠다는 생각으로 좀 기다리고 있었습니다.
그래서 최종전 저글링 컨트롤이 너무 좋았습니다. 근데 이번 시즌 이 좀 뚫고 올라가야 할 저그들이 굉장히 많잖아요. 저그 원탑 자리를 다시 되찾기 위해서는 각오가 어떠세요?
일단은 오늘 하면서도 느꼈는데 저그대 저그전을 좀 많이 연습을 해야 될 것 같아요. 아무래도 저그도 많고 그래서 아직 이제 또 16강 시작하는 아직 멀었으니까 이제 기량 많이 올려보도록 하겠습니다.
네, 또 김정우 선수의 복귀를 정말 두 팔 벌려 환영하는 팬분들이 굉장히 많습니다. 팬들에게도 한 말씀 해주시죠.
네, 오랫동안 이제 기다려주시고 이제 이번 시즌 시작하면서도 응원 많이 해주셨는데 이렇게 16강 그래도 올라가게 돼서 너무 다행인 것 같고 이제 팬 여러분들에게도 실망 안 시켜드린 것 같아서 나름 뿌듯하고요. 앞으로 이제 시작이니까 예, 더 좋은 모습 보여드리도록 하겠습니다. 감사합니다.
네, 이번 시즌 김정우 선수의 멋진 모습 기대하겠습니다. 인터뷰 고맙습니다. 네,
감사합니다.
자, 이렇게 해서 24강 개막전 경기 두 번째로 16강에 진출한 김정우 선수와 이야기 나눠봤습니다.
Okay, guys, thank you so much for joining us on the first day back here. As you can see, we have our two Zerg surviving to the round of 16.
Yeah, definitely the two favorites of the group.
Yeah.
It takes a long time, guys, to actually come up and even get into ASL. And generally, when you first get into ASL, it takes you several seasons to even win a map. And that's kind of what you're seeing here. We've seen Barracks and Sins both in ASL before, and I think we'll see them in ASL again. But it's probably going to be a while before they can make it deep because there are monsters like Hero and Effort.
Yeah. Group B is just around the corner, and this is going to be a fun one.
Dude, this group is insanity. YSC is a really strong Protoss. Obviously, Shine's been in the finals before, a fantastic Zerg. But what I'm talking about here is Light. He's the second best Terran in the world, the best Terran in this tournament. And then Royal, generally considered right now to be the fourth best Terran in the world. So
yeah,
if we don't have two Terrans coming out of this group, we won't have two Terrans coming out of any group.
Will Artosis get the build orders he needs to stay in S? Stay tuned here at ASL.
Yeah.
We're gonna find out.
Oh, it's gonna be
today
just
definitely
blast.
Didn't help me at all, by the way, Artosis.
You gotta use that Reaver build on Eclipse, Stasis.
Yeah, I'll try it out.
I bet you'll actually get wins with that. You go back and rip that build?
Guys, come to my stream and let me know that, you know, ask me. Can Reaver stop that when I get
clearly,
the bus coming?
Clearly, the Corsair Reaver, Mass Reaver, plus 25 damage. It was kind of sick. But yeah, guys, this is the next group, and it is going to be awesome. I actually can't wait. I cannot wait to cast that.
I am so excited to have a group like this. I always like seeing what Shine does. Shine always shows, you know, what an abstract Zerg can do.
Yeah,
we're back on camera.
Yeah, here we are, guys. This has been fantastic.
I'm getting nostalgic doing this with you. You know, the last time we were casting like this was before StarCraft 2 was out. We were doing StarCraft 1 stuff in your apartment.
That's
when you were
true.
Living in Gangnam.
That's true. Yeah. We did like some the TSL tournament and some other stuff as well.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. It was probably 12 years ago.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
Yeah. And I'm like, here we are again doing it. This is
That's
fun.
That's true. And it's always my apartment.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's
isn't
not that
my place. I come to you, Artosis, yeah, always.
That's right. That's right.
Guys, thank you so much for joining us here. And thank you, everybody who supported us on Patreon. If you want to check our Patreon out, it's patreon.com/ASL.
ASL English. Also, yeah, we're going to be posting all sorts of stuff there, updates, photos, behind the scenes stuff. Just for you guys, just as a big thanks. It's like not something that we talked about before, but yeah, we want to let you guys know about that. And yeah, stay tuned. We're going to be doing a couple seasons of ASL this year, and we're working on
some other stuff too. So hopefully this is just the beginning. And again, thank you for helping us keep the history of competitive Brood War alive.
Yeah. And it looks like it's going to be a fantastic season, to be honest.
Yeah,
like I mean, a lot of jokes around here and there with the number of Terrans that have qualified, but
yeah.
A lot of exciting ones in there. And this is just the round of 24. The round of 24 is way weaker than the round of 16, which is phenomenally weaker than the round of 8.
Well,
and then
when the
round of 4, it's like stupid.
When the round of 8 comes, that's when the chills kick in for me.
Yeah.
Because that's when we get the really long series, a lot of planning. The maps are always so important. You know, Brood War, you can really play a different game depending on the map.
Yeah.
That is
one
thing that this game has, I think, over every other RTS that's out there.
Oh, yeah. No, different maps play
insanely differently.
Yeah.
And I think we've got some great maps for this season.
Yeah, no, I'm very excited about some of these maps. Ascension looks amazing. That map, like, I love Blue Storm, but the, like, three-player maps are another one of, like, the things that I really fancy because they can't be cut in half.
Right,
like,
right.
That just automatically makes it interesting.
For sure.
Yeah. So just having another cool three-player map is amazing, and the fact that it's placed off Blue Storm is cool. Some of these other ones I'm going to reserve judgment on. We're gonna have to cast a little bit more, maybe play some games on them and figure
them
out.
Yeah. We're going to learn some of these maps along with you guys.
Yeah,
we got to keep talking. You want to throw those crane casters back on the screen? We have the power to do this.
Yeah, look at that. I run it now, guys.
Yes.
Oh man, yeah, they got their beautiful yellow jackets, and we got our.
You know what this
on.
Is? What? You know what's happening right now? They're making them keep talking because the show was short.
Yeah, I guess the games this were kind of short tonight. Everyone just kind of died.
We can talk about this now because we're not there anymore. But yeah, this will happen where the games are short, and we've basically said everything we need to say. But I think they just want to run the stream for a little bit more time.
Yeah. Well, you feel like you're kind of. You know, cheating the fans almost mm-hmm. because it's like, well, it was quicker than expected, right?
The
like,
fans want those guys drinking more hot six. StarCraft is a sideshow, Artosis.
for sure. But it was quick, right? When you look at it, it's like
most of the games are rushes today.
Yeah, they were, and this can happen in the round of 24. It is best of one, but also when you look at the players that are really good in the group, it's like this group happened to have two Zergs that were favored. So, if a Zerg player is way better than you, they can actually kill you relatively quickly compared to some of the other matchups.
Yeah, today is called, we're not going to have a third base day.
Yeah.
The first game was actually pretty long, but...
Yeah, that one, I think that was probably the best game of the day.
Yeah, well, it makes you think, right? I mean, depending on what the map is, maybe you can do a Reaver Crawl push into a Zerg.
Yeah. Well, I hope to see more of that. And honestly, the double armory build, the fact that Barracks did it tells me that it exists. And now,
well, it's not the first
I'm
time in StarCraft
it.
It's been done. It's the first time we saw it. But, you know, sometimes there are these builds
Walled Expo,
that are, like, floating up in S rank and A rank that, you know, people are tinkering with. And, you know, eventually it trickles down into a tournament that we cast. And then the meta changes because of it.
Oh, absolutely. And unfortunately, we didn't get to see too much of it there. No. But, that was really peculiar. And I'm excited about that. But
some beard dandruff on me here. Did I wear my right shirt so they know I'm a
Bullet
gamer?
Bill? Yeah, man. Yeah. Look at you.
Look at you, dinosaur horse.
Dinosaur horse.
Guys, I think that's all the time we have. We love you. Take care. We'll see you for Group B real soon. Bye-bye.